Pepper Bottler present Big 12 football. This afternoon from Lincoln, Nebraska, the Iowa State Cyclones take on the Cornhuskers of Nebraska. Let's take a look at the AP Top 5, and you can see despite their close victory over Missouri, the Huskers have fallen to number 3 behind Michigan and Florida State. Nebraska has won 2 of the last 3 national championships. Their quest to make it 3 out of 4 begins this afternoon against Iowa State, a team that doesn't give up and plays hard every game. Hello again, everybody. I'm Rob Doolin, and I welcome you to underneath Memorial Stadium, the trophy room at the Hewitt Center. And in the trophy room, you can see all the hardware that attests to Nebraska's success. The Heisman trophies, the Lombardi trophies, and the national championship trophies. But all this success has a foundation. My broadcast partner, Dave Lapham, has more on that.
This is the 30,000 square foot weight room at Nebraska. Players you're going to see today, Scott Frost, Amon Green, Aaron Taylor, Grant Wistrom, all paid the price for excellence. We all know a strong athlete is a confident athlete. Right in this very room is where the foundation is built for national championship opportunity. Ron?
Thank you, Dave. Nebraska has won 37 consecutive conference games. The last time they lost a conference game, almost 5 years to the date, November 14th, 1992, the team to beat them, Iowa State. We'll step aside and we'll have more from Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska, after this word from Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler.
From Columbus, Nebraska.
Welcome back to a sold-out Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska, where we are minutes away from kickoff between Nebraska and Iowa State. Hello, everyone. I am Jim Knox. If Iowa State has any chance of pulling off the upset against Nebraska today, Darren Davis has to play, and he has to play well. Davis, who went down last week with the deep thigh bruise, he sustained the injury against Colorado on this play. Now, Davis is expected to play today, and when Davis plays, he will play with added protection. That's right, an extra knee pad. What Frank Randall has done, the Iowa State trainer, is he devised a knee pad. It extends up to his thigh area. It will have extra protection on the thigh. The question is, will he be able to withstand the tough blows that Nebraska defense throws at him today? Well, we will soon see. It's the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Game of the Week, Nebraska and Iowa State, and it's coming your way next.
Nebraska, as the Cornhuskers are looking for their 42nd consecutive home win. And it's going to be a good one against Iowa State. The weather, it is chilly, wind chill. Hey, Jim Knox, it's -2, big guy. Cloudy and cool, but we don't have any snow as of yet, and that is the good news. Of course, coaching staff for the respective teams. On your left, Tom Osborne in his 25th year. His record is just short of incredible. Dan McCartney in his third year at Iowa State. He is building a big foundation, but he knows playing up here in Lincoln, Nebraska today is going to be a very difficult chore for his troops.
Well, I've been there before, but you know, a lot of these kids that are playing right now have it because we have so many young kids on the field. And I've never been in a stadium or atmosphere in my life that's more intimidating than Lincoln, Nebraska for a football game. So we got our work cut out for us as a coaching staff to make sure these kids believe that they can line up and play against Nebraska.
Dave Lapham, it's going to be a difficult chore for them, and their margin of error for this afternoon for Iowa State is nil.
Right, they're going to have to play just about the perfect game. There's no question about it. They can't give Nebraska any extra opportunities at all.
There's Tyrone Watley set to receive Chris Brown's opening kick. Over 76,000 on hand, and we are underway. It'll be Watley right at about the one. Ooh. Takes a stick, stays on his feet, and he will be buried at the 10-yard line. A return of 10, and that is where Iowa State will take over. Quarterback for Iowa State is Todd Bandauer, the junior out of Crystal River, Florida. And last week we saw him play, and I tell you what, Dave, his first half was probably one of the best halves he has played this year.
He was outstanding. He can throw the football exceptionally well. 19 touchdowns, a mere 7 interceptions. If you have a 2-to-1 ratio in favor of the touchdown, it's outstanding. He is well beyond that ratio.
Well, Darren Davis is going to be playing. He is going back to the tailback spot. He'll be joined by Joe Parmentier, number 42, the fullback. Bandauer not expected to have a whole lot of time throwing the football today. Look for quick drops. Not from the tailback, however, as Davis stays on his feet. Let's take a look at our Southwest Airlines starting lineup, first of all, for the Iowa State offensive line. Oliver Ross, the big left tackle. Can he handle Grant Wistrom? They say he's a pro prospect. We'll find out this afternoon. The running backs and wide receivers, Tyrone Watley, leads the Big 12 in receiving yards per game. Had a couple of touchdown receptions last week versus Colorado. There's Darren Davis, younger brother of Troy Davis. Joe Parmentier is being helped off the field, the big fullback.
Darren Davis has got that little extra protection around his face as Joe Parmentier departs, and he's trying to fight that wind chill.
Iowa State has not won here in Lincoln since 1977. Bandauer, the pressure on, and Pat is going to be incomplete, intended for Jerome Heavens. Southwest Airlines defensive starting lineup for the Nebraska defense. All-American Grant Wistrom, only 4.5 sacks away from getting the all-time sack mark here at Nebraska. The linebacker, Tony Ortiz, just a sophomore, starting his first game for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. And in the secondary, Ralph Brown. In 1996, he was a freshman All-American, and he leads the team in solo tackles. And already, Iowa State off schedule, 3rd and 8.
Yeah, exactly. They bounce the ball off the turf, Darren Davis does. He recovers on first down. Second down, Bandauer behind the receiver, 3rd and long.
Watley wide to the left. Green in motion. They're going to go deep right down the middle. Wide open, and Bandauer overthrows him. Tyrone, or I take it back, number 81, Ed Williams, had a step on him. Just overthrew him. Bandauer throwing into the wind.
And that's the matchup that Iowa State feels they've got an advantage. Iowa State's wide receivers against the young secondary from Nebraska. Missouri exposed this young secondary in the play-action pass last week. Went right over the top, ran right by the coverage. Octavius McFarland, not close enough to Ed Williams. If that ball's thrown more accurately, it could be a touchdown, and you have to capitalize on those opportunities. You can't let a big play potential escape you.
Carl Gomez, the left footer, into the wind, high kick. Going to take a favorable bounce for Iowa State, but it will be excellent position for the Nebraska Cornhuskers as they will take over just about at the 50-yard line after a 43-yard kick. Scott Frost, the senior quarterback, believe it or not, last year people were questioning his abilities, but this year he has proven that he can run the option, and he has made great decisions this year.
Scott Frost, if he passes for 148 yards and rushes for 167, Ron, he's the 10th player in NCAA history to rush and throw for 1,000 or more. That would be quite an accomplishment.
Just his decision-making this year has improved so much. He's going to run the option on the first play, pitching it back. Lots of running room over the right side. Amon Green. Once again, Southwest Airlines presents the offensive line, the starters, and of course, Aaron Taylor. 18 pancake blocks versus Missouri last week, closing in on 100 for the season. And of course, number 30, Amon Green, second all-time rushing list in Nebraska history, averaging 143 yards a game.
Fourth best in the entire nation.
Right in front of Green is number 45, Joel Makavica. Makavica will keep it straight up the middle, inside the 35, down to the 33-yard line. And Southwest Airlines brings us the Iowa State defense. Greg Schoen is the biggest of the defensive linemen, but he has to play even bigger today against Aaron Taylor. At the linebacker spot, Michael Cooper, the leading tackler, 17 stops versus Colorado last week. Out of the secondary, the redshirt freshman out of Ames, Dustin Avey, a 94-yard interception return for a touchdown last week. But they will have their hands full. 2nd and 5 for the Cornhuskers. Frost keeps it. A lot of running room. Inside the 25, inside the 20, down to the 18-yard line. Chin Achebe had to come from that outside linebacker spot to make the stop. Let's take a look at the numbers on Scott Frost out of Wood River, Nebraska. Had a great game versus the Tigers last week.
Well, those are numbers that you expect out of your tailback. Averaging over 6 yards a crack, 14 touchdowns, 852 yards on the ground. You have a double threat. I mean, Amon Green, 4th in the nation. Scott Frost, a legitimate threat running the football. Nebraska, powerful. Number 1 in the entire country running the ball.
Green tries the left side. Big hole, touchdown, Nebraska.
Wow. This football team, Ron, is so powerful. Averaging 395 yards a game on the ground. And that time just went through the Iowa State defense like a hot knife through butter. And nothing fancy at all. Just ran the option. Just a straight dive, little isolation, fullback lead. Increased the defense dramatically.
Well, they're number 1 in the NCAA in rushing, total offense, and scoring. And they showed why on that. Chris Brown, the junior out of Southlake, Texas, to attempt the extra point straight through the uprights for Chris. He is 48 of 48 this year. 18-yard touchdown run by Green puts the Huskers on the board here in the first. Corby Jones hit number four. Ricky Ross in the end zone to send the game to overtime. Heard.
The snap back to Scott Cross. He looks. Drives the pass in the end zone. Incomplete. Yes, he caught the ball for the touchdown.
Holy cow, Matt Davis.
The Missouri fans, they're running down to tear down the goalpost. They don't realize the Huskers have scored.
Chris Brown's extra point was good and the game went into overtime. That's when Cornhusker quarterback Scott Frost took charge and scored what proved to be the winning touchdown. Well, Amon Green has already put the Huskers on the board 7-0. Tom Osborne telling us yesterday that that was the craziest game he's ever won. Says he's been involved in a lot. Here's Watley from inside the five, straight up the middle with a running room. 27 yards on the return. Let's take a look at our Mazda scoring drive. Only took Nebraska four plays to cover 51 yards and took them 77 seconds.
Four plays all on the ground, and they cover half the football field. Todd Bandauer wishes he had one back.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he had Ed Williams in that first drive that just overthrew him. And you have to take advantage of every opportunity presented to you when you're a decided underdog, and already Iowa State has let one slip through their fingertips on their first possession.
Well, now you have Amon Green, the lone setback. Two wide receivers to the right, one to the left. Williams in motion. Davis. Stacked up, and he is going to be dropped. Jason Peter right in the middle of things. Peter with 48 tackles coming into the game, 12 tackles for a loss already this season.
Well, he lines up right next to Grant Wisdom. They're the dynamic duo. Let's take a look at Ed Williams on the first possession. Comes off the line of scrimmage as a slot receiver, runs right past the coverage. I mean, he is wide, wide open. Octavius McFarland, the linebacker, can't stay with him. Overthrown. If he catches that football, it could be golden goalpost, and the game might be tied right now.
Missouri was able to take advantage of that last week. There were guys wide open. Davis is going to be hammered as he gets to the 25, but he actually lost 2 yards. Again, number 55, Jason Peter, the senior out of Locust, New Jersey.
I'll tell you, he's not only penetrating, disrupting, he's making tackles behind the line of scrimmage. Back-to-back tackles for loss by Jason Peter. Here's the touchdown, a little counterplay where the right guard, right tackle get their blocks. Off to the races, Amon Green. He would have scored and touched football. I don't think anybody even laid a fingernail on him.
Well, their first series, they face 3rd and 8. Second, it's 3rd and 12 for Iowa State. Just about 4 minutes gone by here in the first. Penalty flags are thrown and
false start.
False start. We're going to move it back a little bit further.
Well, now you got tackle for loss on first and second down. Then you jump early on third down. Now you're facing 3rd and long. You're off schedule big time, and you can't have that.
Steve Juszczyk, our referee this afternoon.
Take a look at what Iowa State has to do here, Ron, to win this football game.
Ball start, offense, 5-yard penalty, repeat 3rd down.
And the biggest key for Iowa State was to stay on schedule like we're just talking about by down and distance. They're way off schedule right now, 3rd and a bundle. No margin for error. They have to take advantage of every opportunity already in the first possession. They did not. And they have to challenge that Nebraska secondary. In order to do that, they have to protect, pass protect for Todd Bandauer. We'll see if they can keep Peter and Wistrom off of Bandauer.
Well, 3rd and 17, Iowa State going to keep two in the backfield to help with the blocking. Bandauer still sees pressure, goes right down the middle of the outside. Pass is knocked down, incomplete.
Sweeney got his hand up there real late. I mean, Watley on Sweeney, that's a matchup they like. The receivers on the corners. Sweeney, he was pivoting, spinning around up there, trying to find the football. At the last second, he did and got a hand on it. Right at the top of the screen, Watley trying to run by Sweeney. He turns to find the ball late and just gets his right hand on that football just a little bit. Once again, close for Iowa State, but no cigar. Close doesn't count. You have to execute.
Carl Gomez set to kick it away. Bobby Newcomb. Standing at about the 50-yard line, set the receiver, kicking into the wind, bobbles the snap, gets it away. Hangs up in the air, Newcomb's going to take it. Penalty flag is thrown, goodbye! penalty flag is thrown. Newcomb unofficially 53 yards. Let's see who the penalty's against.
Boy, if it's an illegal block in the back, it nullifies a touchdown. If it's against Iowa State, of course, it stands. Let's see what the officials are going to call.
We have a halo violation on a kicking team.
Halo violation meaning you have to give 5 yards to receive the punt. You can't impede his vision. You have to break down 5 yards away from the punter, give him a clear vision to catch the football. Newcomb didn't need it. Even though there was a violation of his space, he caught the ball, and it was see you later.
That's the first punt return for a touchdown this year for the Cornhuskers. They were averaging just about 10 yards a return. And talking to both coaches, both felt the specialty teams would make the difference today. So far, it has for Iowa State. Chris Brown's extra point again. True to the mark. We're still in the first quarter. We have played just about 5 minutes. Nebraska on top. 14-0 is our score. Kluber was the culprit on the halo violation. That allowed Newcomb to have the punt return of 53 yards for a touchdown. He had a 57-yarder earlier this year, but it didn't go as a touchdown. Of course, the record, 92 yards by Johnny Rogers. Infamous game in 1971.
I tell you, Newcomb is becoming a weapon. Every time he touches the football, it's a big play waiting to happen in all phases.
Watley from the 10, straight up the middle. He is going to be stood up at about the 27-yard line, falls forward to the 30. Let's take a look at that punt return again by Bobby Newcomb.
Well, first of all, it's a low line drive kick, so it's returnable. Kluber, 47 in the white jersey, runs by him. There's a 5-yard area that you're not supposed to violate. It's violated by Kluber. Newcomb doesn't care, though. It's a low-line drive. There's great blocking right up immediately at his semi-wedge area. And then speed just absolutely detonates Iowa State. Nobody can come close. Watch the blocks. As soon as Newcomb breaks the initial line of scrimmage, it's off to the races. And you get out in the open field one-on-one against the punter. He's not going to make the play. He runs by Gomez without much problem at all.
Look at the numbers on Newcomb this year. 352 yards total offense.
I had the center forget the snap count here.
Everybody moved, but the big guy in the middle. Now, we have to mention that Charlie Bogwell, the normal center, number 79 for Iowa State, is not playing. He dislocated his elbow last week against Colorado, but to tell you how tough he is, he went back in the game and just started snapping with his left hand, but today he's just not able to go, so Ben Baudette, number 70, has moved over to the center spot, and Bill Marsaw, number 72, has moved up to the right guard spot.
It is tough, but that's a heck of a job by Bogwell being ambidextrous. But now you have to shuffle.
Now.
You have to shuffle your offensive line. You can see that big contraption on his right elbow. It looks like an erector set hanging off his right shoulder to his wrist. That thing is stabilizing that right elbow that he dislocated. He's tough.
Hey, he wasn't expected to play. Now we see him in. Bandauer, pass is going to be incomplete. The black shirts is what they call this Nebraska defense. They are in the top 20 in 3 of 4 categories: rush defense, total defense, and scoring defense. And really, David, you think about Nebraska's defense, their best defense just may be their offense.
Well, yeah, they play keep away, Ron, except when they go on those one-play drives that they're capable of. But Nebraska beats you up in that running game so much, they wear you down. Charlie McBride, though, he's very, very pleased with the Nebraska style of offense because it demoralizes the opponent. Defense gets out there, gets caught up in that momentum, a couple of big plays, 3 and outs, and it becomes a tidal wave.
No yards offense for Iowa State. Bandauer is 0 for 4, making 0 for 5, intended for Tyrone Watley. The sixth-year senior, Erwin Sweeney, on the coverage, number 16. Freshman out of Lincoln, Nebraska.
Well, what they're trying to do is get Todd Bandauer out of rhythm. And he's thrown the ball behind his receivers twice already early in this football game. The reason that he's not accurate is he has to release the football before he wants to. That's because the pressure is getting there. Just as he releases the football, he gets sandwiched. And, you know, a lot of times pressure doesn't equate to just sacks. It's hurries, it's incompletions, it's completion percentage, it's interceptions. Pressure causes a lot of problems for a quarterback.
Again, 3rd and long for Iowa State. Bandauer lets it fly. The pass is going to be incomplete. He was crushed by Jason Peter right as he let go of the football.
Nobody can block Jason Peter up front. They're doing a good job. They're double-teaming Wistrom, but you can't double-team everybody. And Jason Peter is just doing an incredible job at the line of scrimmage. This time, just a whip move up the football field, and it's off to the races. He gets the edge immediately on the offensive lineman, Matt Rafel. And then he got his hit on Bandauer. That's a tremendous upfield rush inside by Jason Peter.
Third punt already for Gomez. Still no yards offense for Iowa State. We're not even out of the first quarter yet. Newcomb set to return this again.
Oh,
another penalty.
Jeez.
Another violation against Iowa State. Now, he didn't even catch the football when they hit him.
Now, was Kevin Wilson blocked into him? I don't think so. I think Kevin Wilson could have stopped on his own.
Yeah, I
now,
agree.
If he was blocked into him, it's a different deal, but there's handkerchiefs everywhere. There's yellow laundry all over this football field. That wasn't a halo violation. That was a worse violation than the halo.
That was a halo detonation.
Yeah, that was a halo assault.
There's no halo on Mr. Wilson right now.
No, he's growing a couple of horns right
there. I think
there.
He is.
Fair catch. Interference on a kicking team. Will be a 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And as a result of that misfortune on the kicking game on special teams, Nebraska once again with a short field to operate from. I mean, Iowa State's defense has their hands full as it is. You'll see Wilson, number 25, just run right through him. He's not blocked into him. I don't know what Wilson was thinking. That's just a serious brain cramp right there that cost his football team big time. Now the defense has a short field, and they're trying to hold back a tidal wave as it is.
Already now 14-0. Green over the left side again. Running room. Left side.
See ya.
20. Touchdown, Nebraska.
Wow.
Unofficially 49 yards for Amon Green. His 16th rushing touchdown of the year. His longest this year was 59. That goes for 49.
Just a simple double team right up the gut. That got it started, and then it was all Amon Green running right through tackles. Nobody can arm tackle Amon Green, and then he turns the jets onto the perimeter, and he outruns everybody. It's amazing. This offensive line from Nebraska is starting to dominate very early.
Chris Brown getting a workout. That touchdown ties him with Tommy Frazier for fourth in Nebraska history with 36 rushing touchdowns in a career. Defensive coordinator for Iowa State, John Scladaney, pleading with his troops. Get a little bit more physical with this Nebraska team because that is something they have to do if they even want to stay close in this game. Nebraska's had the ball only a minute and 27 seconds, and Amon Green with a couple of runs has helped Nebraska to a 21-0 lead with 10:09 left in the, believe it or not, first quarter.
Amon Green has got 16 touchdowns rushing on the season now, two early ones today.
Watley's going to take a seat in the end zone. Iowa State will begin first and 10 from their own 20.
65% of Chris Brown's kickoffs going to the end zone. Watley's 100% of his runs seem to be touchdowns. Double team at the line of scrimmage, rub off to the linebacker, level excellently by Aaron Taylor. And then Amon Green is in the open green spaces, and he's off to the races, and it's see you later. And that's where the biggest mismatch is, the team speed. Nebraska's team speed is so much more impressive than what Iowa State can present. That's a total mismatch. It's dramatic,
yeah.
The team speed differential in this football game.
Iowa State having problems establishing any kind of rushing game. Davis, 3 carries, 0 yards. Bandauer is going to be dunked at the 10. Number 84, Mike Rucker, the junior out of St. Joseph's, Missouri.
Well, they figure that Bandauer is getting some pressure in the pocket, so what do? Try to get him out of pocket. Parmentier is the guy that's blocking on the perimeter on the defensive end. He runs right by him. That's a total mismatch. Rucker just absolutely doesn't see Parmentier as an obstacle at all and deposits Bandauer. I mean, he's getting pressure in the pocket. They try to get him out of pocket, and he gets additional pressure. Boy, sometimes you can't make any kind of call that'll work.
Well, Nebraska's defense has 12 goals. They may meet all 12 of those goals today. Left side, Davis takes a big hit as he crosses the 15.
Johnson.
Eric Johnson, the junior from Phoenix, Arizona, number one, coming up and lowering the boom on Davis.
Now, Darren Davis is a running back with great speed. Problem is, this linebacker, Johnson, runs a 10-5, 10-6 hundred meter himself. Let's see what this, here, listen to this. That's a shot.
How about when it's cold, Dave?
Oh,
that's got to hurt.
Yeah, you feel like you crack every bone in your body when you hit that turf in that cold weather.
But it is still third down and 14 again. Iowa State, third and long. Penalty flags. It's going to make it even longer.
Another false start.
Boy, when your margin of error is very, very slim, and we're not degrading Iowa State, that's just the reality of the situation, you can't afford any kind of penalties. Andy Stensrud, the big freshman tight end, I think is the one who moved.
Well,
you notice how cold it is, our official, our referee, Steve Juszczyk, the chin's getting a little stiffer every time he talks, Dave. You notice that?
Yeah, exactly.
Getting a little tighter down there.
Exactly. But you look at the Nebraska defensive linemen, all sleeveless. This is the weather that the black shirts love to play. Look at this. None of these guys have jerseys underneath their football jerseys. They're wearing the short sleeves. It's like a day at the beach for these guys. They're ready to go after it.
Yesterday during practice, it was snowing and it was colder, and they came out with like tank tops on. Bandauer again, right down the middle, has a man and is incomplete. Intended for Tyrone Watley, Irwin Sweeney, the freshman from Lincoln, Nebraska, again on the coverage. That pass, though, was on the money.
And you got a penalty flag. Let's see if we have a roughing or get a holding against Iowa State. That's going to cost them even more yards, or Nebraska will decline this and make them punt. It's already third and a bunch.
On the offense, penalty is declined, fourth down.
Now, take a look at, they double-team Wistrom. They stay after him a little bit. They give Bandauer an opportunity to have vision down the football field, but now you have a young secondary gaining confidence. It's amazing what a 21-0 lead early will do for your confidence. And Sweeney, tighter coverage on that particular snap. Everybody's feeling good right now.
Well, Iowa State, 12 plays, minus 4 yards. Bandauer is 0-for-7 throwing the football. Look out! Almost blocked. The up man is going to take it up to the 32-yard line is number 5, Shevin Wiggins. Well, you wonder what these guys on Nebraska, what they feed them. How about for an 11:30 kickoff? Jim Knox, give us the menu, big guy.
Okay, Ron, you know, Nebraska looks like they have a little extra energy today. Could be that pregame meal, 7:30 this morning. Let's take a look. The menu. Now, we couldn't possibly list all the items on the board, but just some of the items in the quantities. Eggs, 40 dozen. Then waffles, 100 servings. Not to mention 4 gallons of maple syrup to wash down the waffles. As far as Dave Lapham's pregame meal, we'll get to that in just a second. Here it is. Dave Lapham's pregame meal. We calculated eggs, 10. Canadian bacon, just 1 slab. Pancakes, 8 stacks. Syrup, 1 gallon. That's the usual Dave Lapham pregame meal. Ron?
And guys, that turkey was a 12-pounder that I carcassed solo. I carcassed that bad boy by myself.
That doesn't include supper last night.
Absolutely.
Well, Nebraska leading 21-0, 8:51 left in the first. Amon Green, 3 carries, 80 yards already. A couple of touchdowns. He's going to get another shot. This time over the right side, inside the 30, down to about the 27-yard line before Chinatibi comes up to make the stop. Already Amon Green over 1,360 yards this season, 5th best total in Nebraska history.
Well, the thing about Scott Frost is he's so much more decisive in his decision-making. Amon Green, of course, rolling up some serious numbers, but Scott Frost, you take a lot of things for granted, and one thing that Scott Frost has improved upon is his accuracy of the pitch in the option. Amon Green, if you hit him full stride, just like a pass, he's going to hit that defense going 100 miles an hour. If you throw it behind him or make him stop, he has to restart. Frost is much more effective with the option.
There you see it right there. Is Frost able to cross the 20, gets enough for the first down. As Dave mentioned, he's closing in on a 1,000 season. 1,000 yards passing the football, 1,000 yards rushing the football. He was 75 yards away from a quarterback rushing record coming into today.
Last week in the Missouri game, he came 2 attempts short and 3 yards short of school records in each category. I mean, he was responsible for well over 300 yards offense by himself, throwing and running the football. He rushed for 4 touchdowns. He is a specimen.
9 straight games, Nebraska has rushed for 350. Here comes the reverse to Newcomb. Left side, he's got some blocking. Going to be knocked out of bounds at the 4 as he hesitated. Doug Densmore, number 24, a redshirt freshman out of Sterling, Illinois, finally corralled him.
Well, down the field, they say if a wide receiver throws a block that leads to a touchdown, it's called a blazer. And they chart the wide receiver's blocks. The offensive line, you see some knockdowns there, guys down on the ground. They like the wide receivers to knock down people, too. Newcomb on the perimeter, down the football field. You have big offensive linemen working, trying to spring Newcomb to the end zone. That's the very versatile Matt Hoskinson down the field. Couldn't quite get the defender on the turf.
Interesting formation. Green, left side, bouncing. Can he get in? Yes, touchdown, Nebraska.
Amon Green wants to show you the total package. He's shown you the speed, the cutting ability. Now he wants to show you that he can lower his shoulder pads and play with power. And Amon Green has got the total package. Speed, agility, quickness, and power. It's a double-I formation, a power-I formation. Makovicka gets a block. Amon Green just drives the pile back to the goal line and pierces it. That's great surge right there by Amon Green showing some power.
Well, as Chris Brown from Southlake, Texas, just outside of Dallas, kicks it, he wants to make sure that we tell his sister good luck as she tries out for the volleyball team. That man doesn't need any luck. Five rushes, 88 yards, three touchdowns for Amon Green. And with 7:37 left in the first, it's 28-0, Nebraska on top. Iowa State, a 44-point underdog coming into this football game. Now it's a matter of pride.
Well, Tom Osborne, of course, his football team last week showed some poise and confidence by tying that football game up. They have to go a bunch of yards with only a minute and 2 seconds on the clock. They go 67 yards in 10 plays with a minute and 2 seconds to go to tie it up in the air. Scott Frost doing a great job. Now that they've been tested a little bit, they had their wake-up call. They're taking that on Iowa State.
Let's take a look at the North standings. And you can see Nebraska on top. A win today will send them to San Antonio for the Big 12 championship game. Kansas State at 5-1, 8-1, they are bowl-bound. Missouri, what a job they did last week. Larry Smith has done just a spectacular job. You know, we saw them against Kansas State. We saw them against Kansas, and they didn't look good. But, boy, they have really come out. And the South standings, Oklahoma State, Texas A&M battling to see who will play Nebraska in San Antonio on December the 6th at the Alamo Dome. Eight straight 100-yard rushing games for Amon Green at 99 yards in the first game. He is on his way to the ninth straight.
And he had 99 yards against Akron to start the season. He came within 1 yard of having 100 yards rushing in every game this season.
Nebraska's only had the ball 2 minutes and 46 seconds. They have 132 yards and 21 points. Lotley again from in the end zone. Crosses the 20. Skirts to the outside, dancing his way up to about the 39-yard line before he is knocked out of bounds. A 39-yard return for Tyrone Watley, and this is the best field position Iowa State has been able to start with this afternoon.
No question about it. Watley made Joe Walker miss. Joe Walker was in position. Watley takes it out of the goal line, and Watley on his own bounces to the outside. Watch Joe Walker in the red, number 25, misses the tackle. And as a result of that miss, Watley's out the gate and up the sideline for additional yards. So Nebraska's human. They even missed a tackle. I can't believe it.
Now we had a penalty, I believe, on the play. Let's listen in.
We have sideline interference on the kicking team.
Sideline interference. That is the first, I think, in 10 games you and I have had this year, Dave.
Sideline interference, and the return went in front of the return team's bench, so they must have crowded the side. You have to give a five-yard barrier. You see how everybody's off the sideline by 5 yards. There's a second white line away from the sideline that's 5 yards away. You can't get in that white strip right there. That's 5 yards in width, and if you're crowding that, if there are more bodies in there than just the coaches, you got trouble, and that's what they were called Nebraska on, I believe. Is crowding that sideline too much.
Usually we hear a warning.
Right. Maybe they already gave a warning. Yeah. And second offense, then the flag is dropped.
We have sideline interference on a kicking team during the run back. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Now this is an opportunity for Iowa State, obviously, that they have to take advantage of. You know, you were talking, Dave, about watching that last minute of the game last week. You and I were at St. Louis Airport watching it, and we both commented how calm Tom Osborne was the final 62 seconds. It was remarkable.
He really was, Ron, and I think that calmness filtered right down to his quarterback. Scott Frost showed as much huddle presence as any quarterback I've seen in dire circumstances. He was very, very poised and had tremendous huddle presence.
Davis the right side. There are a bunch of red jerseys to surround him, and he's going to lose about six on the play. Eric Johnson, number one, led the charge.
Tremendous effort by Kelsey. He split a double team. They double teamed Kelsey. He came off of both of them, and he was the disruptor. He's the one that made Davis bounce it to the outside to his teammates. I mean, two guys take the shot at him. They can't get him blocked, and the play is thrown for a five-yard loss. Once again, Iowa State off schedule. That was their big key. Don't give up a lot of tackles for loss and quarterback sacks.
Well, they wanted Iowa State to play with a long field. This is the shortest field they're playing with. You can see the total yards. Not even on the positive side. Bandauer, quick look into Watley. Crosses the 50, gets into Nebraska territory. He won't get a whole lot on that play. This Nebraska defense sets 12 goals. Things they want to get accomplished. One of them is hold the opponent to 13 points and 285 yards. But even their defensive coordinator, Charlie McBride, says really the only goal Nebraska fans want, 0 yards. Yeah. And they're doing that today.
Exactly. There's an injured Nebraska player down on the field. Is that Harrison?
It's number, I think it is.
Harrison. It's Harrison that's got the injury down there. But you're right, Ron. Every defense and every offense has goals for the particular game. Last week in Missouri, Nebraska only met one of the 12 goals, Charlie McBride said, and that was the quarterback sack total when they came up with five quarterback sacks. Other than that, things like points, yards allowed, yards per rush. Another thing that they like to do for their offense is give the offense the football three times in the other team's side of the football field during the course of the game. So things like that they chart. They've got 12 goals they strive for. In prior games, he's had his defense reach as many as 11 of those 12 goals. They only reached one last week against Missouri, so they're trying to make amends for that today, and they're on track to meet a lot of them this afternoon against Iowa State.
Well, only Baylor and Missouri have been able to rush for better than 100 yards against this defense. Third down and 13 for Iowa State again, third and long. Damon Green in motion. Bandauer has some time over the middle to Green. What a catch, and he's hit hard and dropped. The first down of the afternoon for Iowa State, and it comes at the 6:04 mark of the first.
Nice job by Green. Nice route that he ran. Interesting matchup at the line of scrimmage. Oliver Ross working against Wistrom. Oliver Ross gives Bandauer just enough time to get rid of the football, and Bandauer gets it down the field to Green. He makes a very courageous catch of the football. Yep. He knew he was going to get popped, and he still made the catch.
He's a senior out of San Bernardino, California, a JUCO transfer that's finally coming on for Iowa State. First and 10 on the 26 now for the Cyclones. Quick drop, pass overthrown, incomplete, intended again for number 33, Jerome Heavens, the redshirt freshman out of Inglewood, California. Second cousin to Bo Jackson, who gets an attaboy from Bandauer. Knew he overthrew that.
Yeah, Bandauer said, Jerome, no problem on your part. That was all me. You know, I threw that football too hard, too high. Didn't give you an opportunity to make the catch. And that's leadership being shown right there by Bandauer. 2 for 10 for 24 yards. Some of it his fault. A lot of it, though, extreme pressure by Nebraska, making him hurry his reads, throw the ball before he wants to.
On second and 10, Davis stacked up right at the 15. Penalty flag is thrown right at the line of scrimmage.
Boy, if this is a hold on Iowa State, that's a tough penalty. It'll throw him off schedule again. Let's see what the call is.
Holding offense.
That's exactly what it is in the interior. They're having a real hard time blocking Jason Peter inside, a real hard time.
Let's check in with Jim Knox.
Ron, Brandon Harrison, it looks like his day is through. He sustained a concussion, and it doesn't look like he will return to the game, so Brandon Harrison could be through for the day.
Ooh, not good news.
No, concussion in this weather is tough.
I'm really impressed, though, with this Charlie Bogwell, number 79 for Iowa State, as we can see the penalty yards, 5 for 40 already for the Cyclones. The 6'2 junior out of Morris, Illinois, you talked about that big contraption on that right arm.
Yeah.
Dave, I don't see how he could even center the ball.
Now you see the officials made him pat it up a little bit more, Ron. So, I mean, that thing, that contraption he has on there has some sharp edges, but this kid wants to play.
Bandauer's pass is almost picked off.
Wistrom, he dropped out of there in a zone blitz. He dropped into pass coverage and almost made the interception. I mean, Wistrom, he reverse rolls. He drops out of there in the zone blitz. The linebackers rush, and he drops. See, the linebacker blitzes. Wistrom drops off from his defensive end spot. He and Eric Johnson changed responsibilities, and Bandauer never assumed that was going to happen. He never thought that Wistrom was going to be in that throwing lane, and he almost threw the interception.
Has a career record, tackles for a loss for Nebraska. Turned down the NFL last year. Looking forward to this game. Bandauer has some time. Going deep. Has Watley. Touchdown, Iowa State.
And that's the matchup that Iowa State was hoping they could take advantage of. The key is giving Bandauer enough time to make his reads and throw the football. And this young secondary, there are a bunch of freshmen and sophomores back there. Some redshirt freshmen, but Ralph Brown. It's like he was the one that was taken advantage of. It was his own coverage. And they just wasn't a tight enough configuration between safety and corner, and Bandauer abused it.
20th touchdown pass for Todd Bandauer. That is a school record, had it at 19. Jamie Cole will attempt the extra point, but at least Iowa State gets on the board. Maybe they can get something going. And the extra point is good. 5:05 left in the first quarter. 35 points have been scored, 7 by Iowa State, 28 by Nebraska. Let's take a look at that touchdown catch by Tyrone Watley.
Charlie McBride trying to get it squared away on the sideline. Watley to the left side of the formation, and he'll be running his route. It's a zone. Everybody's dropping back in zone. The relationship between corner and safety, Watley right there at the bottom of the screen, the widest guy in the formation. He just splits the safety and corner right there. Not effective enough between the Browns, Ralph and Mike Brown. I mean, they got two guys back there to cover him. Brown's fooled initially. He pulls off late. Brown on the inside is the one that jumped on the wrong route. By the time he recovered back to Watley, it was too late. Ralph Brown hurt his cohort, his buddy in crime, Mike Brown. Or the other way around, Mike Brown hurt Ralph Brown. There's a lot of Browns down there.
Or Ralph Cramden. Doesn't make
Ralph
any difference.
Cramden. He's driving the bus.
Well, Watley, his touchdown pass is number 8 on the year. Bandauer this afternoon, 3 of 12 for 59 yards. Iowa State with 59 yards passing, minus 8 rushing the football.
Well, what you had there is Ralph Brown thought he had Mike Brown for inside help, and Mike Brown was nowhere to be found. He left his buddy Ralph out there on the Brown Island.
Wiggins and Walker set to receive the kick. 5:05 left in the first. Rob Thulin, Jim Knox, Dave Lapham coming to you from Lincoln, Nebraska, a chilly Lincoln, Nebraska.
And a little breeze blowing. That knocked the ball off the tee right there.
It is swirling from left to right.
Let's see if they're going to need somebody to hold this football. I thought I saw Toto fly by a little while ago, but that was unconfirmed.
There he goes again.
Yep. Maybe Toto will have to go down there and hold that ball, but somebody's going to have to make sure. They're going to have to bring a holder in to secure that thing so they get this ball kicked off. We're not in Kansas, are we, NEM?
I'll tell you what, it feels like it. You go outside this booth.
Shoot.
82 consecutive weeks in the top 10 for Nebraska. Showing why right now this afternoon. Wiggins at the 7. Oh. He has some running room. Cuts back. Over the 45, up to the 47-yard line for Shevin Wiggins. His 7th return on the year. And his longest was 31. That goes for 40.
And, of course, Ron, that's the player that kept the ball alive by inadvertently kicking it in the air to his teammate who made the biggest touchdown catch of his career. Wiggins kept that ball alive. You know, they're Iowa State right now, the scoring drive. Watley, a 35-yard touchdown pass. They beat double coverage. Bandauer hits them, so they find themselves on the board. 7 plays to go those 45 yards.
Well, Nebraska's average start is at the Iowa State 44-yard line. This a little bit shorter as Green goes over the right side. Now their average start is at the Iowa State 47. So Nebraska has gotten great field position. You know, you mentioned Shevin Wiggins inadvertently. There was some talk that they were saying that Wiggins said that he intentionally kicked the ball. That was not what he said. The transcript, Chris Anderson of Nebraska Sports Information Department told us about the transcript of that interview. He did not say he intentionally kicked the ball, which obviously would be illegal.
All he said was he kicked the ball. And he didn't say he intentionally kicked the ball. Now, you know, he was doing anything he could to make the catch. He was trying to control the football, and it went airborne.
Uh-oh. Crossed on the option, look out. Crosses the 35, going to be pushed out of bounds at the 30-yard line.
If Makovica could have made the block on Dustin Avey, it would have gone to the house. Because Scott Frost has got 4.6 speed in that range, but Ivy, 400-meter high school hurdler himself, has got real good speed. You'll see Makovica, everybody blocks down some angle blocking, people are secured at the corner. And Makovica can't quite catch Avey, number 7 in the white, and as a result, 7 in the white tackles, 7 in the red at the sideline. If Makovica could have taken Avey down, may have been a big, big one.
12 straight years, this Nebraska offense has averaged 35 points. 7 away from that. This afternoon, pass is going to be complete to number 88, the tight end Sheldon Jackson, the junior out of Diamond Bar, California, his 9th reception on the air. He's a big one at 6'4", 245. Nebraska plays as many as 4 tight ends in the game. A couple of other scores. Penn State, Purdue, will keep an eye on that. Florida State manhandling Wake.
And that's the game that Nebraska's kind of competing with. You know, in this era of polls, score becomes important. With Florida State up by 35, Nebraska didn't like the fact that Iowa State got on the board, so... The big game, though, Michigan's got the biggest test today against Wisconsin. It's kind of that in-between game. They have the big win at Penn State. Ohio State goes up there next week, but Wisconsin's in between.
Green left side, inside the 20, down to about the 16-yard line. Nebraska's averaging, believe it or not, 14 yards per rush.
I believe it.
Yeah, Schoen is on the tackle, number 90 for Iowa State.
What's on my Green averaging? I mean, his average is going to be phenomenal. You know, the thing about Makovica, he's a tremendous blocker at fullback, but here's a kid that's averaging over 7 yards a crack himself, and he's got 8 touchdowns rushing. Amon Green today has 98 yards on 7 carries, over 15 yards per attempt. That's unrealism.
Frost pitches it back. Running room. Bobby Newcomb, touchdown Nebraska.
Wow.
You talked about Newcomb, how he's a do-all guy. We've seen it this afternoon.
Newcomb is nuking him. I mean, this guy is powerful. He's an explosion. Every time he touches the football, he's special to watch. This Nebraska team has so much speed. And where I was impressed with it was when they matched up against Washington. I thought Washington had a lot of quickness, a lot of athletes. Nebraska, looking at tape of that game, looked quicker to me than Washington did. Newcomb's got 88 all-purpose yards. They run a couple of touchdowns to go with it.
The extra point is good, which does not bode well for Iowa State. Nebraska has won 205 consecutive games in which they scored 35 points. They're 269-1 all time, scoring 35 points. The lone loss came to Oklahoma back in 1950.
Well, the big red machine is rolling right now. And the option, the isolation, everything's available to them. Everything's there. Excellent job by Frost making the decision. The pitch man's uncovered. I mean, Iowa State has got some problems of responsibility. Somebody took the quarterback on that play in the option. The pitch man was all by his lonesome. And one thing you can't do against Nebraska is lose responsibility on the pitch man or the quarterback in the option, because that's coffin nails. And the thing, Ron, that makes Nebraska so tough, they have 10 different formations, and they have 20 to 25 running plays out of each formation. So if you're a linebacker, you can't take enough snaps, repetitions in practice to cover everything.
Right.
And Nebraska will come out there with a different look that confuses you, and all it takes is that little instant of self-doubt. Is that the right read and that hesitation? And that's what Nebraska takes advantage of and then blows you up.
You can't have hesitation against guys like Taylor, Zadiska and company. Watley, again, spins, still on his feet, crossing the 25 up to the 27-yard line. So when you talk about great coaches in all of college football, the name of Tom Osborne's right up there with the Joe Paternos and Bobby Bowdens. He's in his 25th year as head coach, 36th year at Nebraska. Look at these numbers on Tom Osborne.
It's incredible. I mean, the guy, he reaches 250 wins in 25 years, better than 10 wins a season, and the numbers are just startling. You know, he's won almost 84% of his games overall. And the continuity in his coaching staff, I think, is the big, big reason. Tom's had some of his stellar coaches here for better than 20 years.
Mandauer trying to throw the football, overthrows the intended receiver, Damon Green. This 35 points that Nebraska's hung on Iowa State in the first quarter, the most in 97 in the first quarter. Previously, it was 28 versus Kansas State.
Well, last week, Missouri had a lead on Nebraska. The first team this year that had a lead on Nebraska after three quarters. They want to make quick restitution for all their problems last week. And Iowa State, unfortunately, you know, is the opponent that is facing Nebraska after being challenged by Missouri. I think whoever they played today was going to have trouble.
Second and 10, Vandauer rolls out, has to dump it off, pass is complete, and Jerome Heavens is immediately hit.
Good shot right there by Warfield. He was all over that. And they really, now Nebraska is playing their rush lanes. They're playing it wide because they realize Vandauer has to try to vacate the pocket a little bit. So they're still pressuring him on the edge. And that time Warfield had man coverage responsibilities on the back out of the backfield underneath, and he blew him up.
Eric Bivens, number 83, is coming to the lineup for Iowa State. Warfield could have played basketball and football at Arkansas. He chose to come to Nebraska instead. Third down and 12. Iowa State just 2 of 6 on third down conversions. Vandauer lost the pass up down the right sideline. It is complete. Good for a first down to Damon Green.
You had a situation where Mike Brown couldn't find the football and Damon Green could. You know, when the receiver on an underthrown football, more times than not, the receiver finds the football before the defensive back can. A little crossing route. Green finds the football. Brown has no idea where it is, particularly when it's underthrown. He makes the adjustment to the football for a nice completion.
Now, this Nebraska defense lost 8 starters from last year. Only 3 starters returned, so it's amazing the numbers that they have put up. But as you mentioned earlier, the secondary is young. Davis, left side, into Nebraska territory, down to about the 40-yard line.
Well, the secondary is young, Ron, and it doesn't have a whole lot of depth. I mean, that's the biggest concern on this football team defensively, is the lack of depth in the secondary. They have a true freshman, Joe Walker, who's played strong safety, corner, nickelback. I mean, when you have a true freshman playing all those positions, it's hard enough for a true freshman to learn one spot. But by need, you have to have them learn 3 spots. Once these young guys get it figured out, though, Charlie McBride says this group of defensive players in the secondary, once they get a little experience under their belt, they might be the best secondary this school's ever had.
Iowa State, 3 straight games, they've scored 21. Davis is going to put it up, throws it up. That is catchable.
Oh,
and he makes the catch.
No,
he dropped it.
Yeah.
Boy, I thought Ed Williams may have come up with a spectacular reception.
He had it for a second, but then he lost it in the turf. He trapped it down there with the turf. But Davis last week, remember the option pass to Watley, and Watley dropped it. This time, the option pass just quite not there enough. He makes Williams stop in his pass route. Davis underthrows this football. He has to throw it going backwards, though, because he's blown up. I mean, even Davis, when he goes on the perimeter, gets blown up. Williams makes a good effort, one hand, right hand up there, tries to secure it as he goes to the turf, can't quite get it done. But it's amazing. Nebraska's all over everything. Ortiz hit Davis as he was throwing that football.
Third down and 2. Davis, right side. Shaking and bacon, crossing the 40 down to the 38-yard line. That will be good enough for a first down. Aaron Sweeney on the stop. Let's check in with Jim Knox. Jim?
Hi, Ron. As we mentioned earlier, about 2 below 0 with the wind chill factor right here. I can't even hardly talk. It's so cold out here. Snow flurries on and off so far this afternoon. How do the Nebraska Cornhuskers, as well as Iowa State players, keep warm? Well, Scott Frost, the quarterback right here, just has the parker on. But a few of his buddies, they had the best idea. You got to go by the heater. That's how you stay warm on a day like this.
Jim, we want to see you with your earmuffs on before the afternoon's over. There you see the wind, and it is nippy outside. Vandauer on 1st and 10. Wow. Into the flat, overthrown. Intended for number 42, Joe Parmentier, the junior fullback at 256 pounds. He's a guard in the backfield. He's not a fullback.
He is. He's an honorary hog. I mean, he's an extra lineman in that backfield, and he knows exactly what his role is. He's a little bit, the coaches are asking him what happened. Now, maybe Joe ran his route a little flat. Vandauer was very inaccurate, but I think Vandauer's mechanics are going to pot because of the pressure. I mean, he's not getting his feet set. He's not able to follow through. That's because Nebraska is in his face.
We are out of the first quarter, and Vandauer's thrown the ball 16 times already.
That's not good.
Not good at all. That pass is incomplete, intended for Green. Vandauer came into this game 115 passes without an interception.
And Vandauer and Green that time, Vandauer saying to Green, look, don't kill me with the wrong route. Vandauer saying, I expect you to continue across the football field. Don't pull up on me. because I'll throw an interception. And that's the thing. A lot of times the quarterback looks bad, but the offensive line might not give him solid enough protection. The back misses a blitz pickup. The receiver runs the wrong route. And all everybody thinks is the quarterback messes up. A lot of times his teammates are messing up.
Third and 10. Vandauer has a lot of people coming. He's hit as he throws it. It's going to be incomplete. Williams was there. Vandauer took a shot in the back.
I think Peter was there once again. Peter was one of them. And if they can just protect a little bit longer for Vandauer, his receivers can beat the secondary. The problem is they don't have enough time to execute the play because of the pressure. And Peter's the one that jacked him in the back as he was releasing that football. That's a whiplash shot. That's like if you're in an automobile and another one hits you from behind and snaps your neck. That's the feeling that the quarterback has right there. Jason Peter is having a great day.
Fourth and 10, and Iowa State is going for it.
Yep, why not?
Exactly. Vandauer has time. Ball is stripped. It's loose. Iowa State will recover it, but it'll belong to Nebraska on downs.
Chad Kelsey is the guy that stripped it. He got the quarterback sack and stripped it out of Vandauer's hands, and Jason Peter comes up with it. The black shirts are doing some damage, and it's all starting up front. The Nebraska defensive line is owning the line of scrimmage, as is the Nebraska offensive line. Therefore, the score is 35-7, and we're still in the first quarter. Kelsey does a nice job of getting up the football field in this pass rush. Todd Vandauer is a battered man already, and they haven't even gotten through the first quarter. Wistrom making the pressure down low. Kelsey up top, knocks it clean. The ball's on the turf. Iowa State can't come up with it. Jason Peter does.
Bobby Newcomb wide to the right, I formation. Makovica, the fullback. Frost is going to put it up. Looks for Newcomb. Got him. And that'll be the end of the first quarter. Bobby Newcomb makes the first down reception. We have played 15, and it's all Nebraska red. Pose for that shot. They did, and now they're frozen.
Yeah.
But inside, it's hot if you're a Nebraska fan. Jim Knox, Dave Lapham, Ron Thulin coming your way from Lincoln, 35-7. Quarter number one is now in the books as we begin the second. First and 10 for Nebraska. Ball on the 24. Reverse. Fake reverse. Amon Green blasts his way down to the 8-yard line. Newcomb scored on the reverse earlier, so now they fake it. Kevin Hudson on the stop.
Boy, the big guys pull from that right guard, right tackle position. Around the horn they go. Amon Green now over 100 yards rushing for the ninth straight game. Amon Green, it's a little counterplay. The big lineman out in front, he fakes a reverse to Newcomb, and he turns it up the football field. Once he gets his shoulder pads squared up to the line of scrimmage and gets them low, he can blow you up. This kid's powerful, got great speed. Amazing. 112 yards on only 8 rushes, and he scored on almost half of them. 3 touchdowns.
This is the longest drive Nebraska's had. Their time of possession that first quarter, 5 minutes, and Frost is going to burn a timeout. Well, Amon Green's already touched pay dirt a couple of times this afternoon, 3 times to be exact. Let's take a look at it.
It's the Amon Green show here. This is nothing fancy, just right between the tackles. He's not touched. I mean, nobody even disturbs his route to the end zone. Then here you have Amon Green breaking it to the outside. Nice lead block by his fullback, and he's off to the races, and he shows his speed. Then on the last touchdown here, look at the power. Lowers his shoulder pads and surges forward, breaks the plane of the end zone. He's shown it all. He's shown speed, agility, power, total package.
35 first quarter points for Nebraska. Not bad. That ties a school record for most points in the first quarter. Also scored 35 against Oklahoma State back in 1988 and Arizona State in 1995.
Well, Nebraska's averaging 510 yards a game offense coming into this game, number one in the country. They're racking up some serious numbers already. Newcomb's already got 109 all-purpose yards. Amon Green's already got 100 yards rushing. Jeez, Watley for Iowa State is a bright spot. On the kickoff return game, he's got 121 yards on returns. Other than that, it's all Nebraska.
First and 8, first and goal on the 8, I should say. Makovica straight up the middle, touchdown Nebraska. Joel Mekovica's ninth rushing touchdown of the year. He only carries about nine times a game, but he averages 7 yards a carry, and he has yet to lose any yards rushing the football this year.
Right, has not been tackled for a loss. That's a fire hydrant right there. A true spark plug at fullback. 7.3 a rush, over 66 yards rushing a game. That leads fullbacks throughout the country. He's tough.
Well, he's also broken his brother Jeff's mark as a fullback for rushing the football. Mekovica adds six more on. The extra point makes it a 42-7 game or early in the second. Joel Mekovica has made it a 42-7 ball game. Just over 14 minutes left here in the opening half in Lincoln, Nebraska. Watley better take a knee, and he does.
Well, the record, the Iowa State record for kickoff return yards is 166. Watley's already got 121 yards in kickoff returns here in the first quarter because Nebraska's been kicking off so much. It truly is amazing. When you have a weapon like Chris Brown run, 65% of his kickoffs go in the end zone. 55% of his kickoffs aren't returned, just like that one. And that nullifies a weapon like Watley. You have a kicker like Chris Brown, it really, really helps your defense because now they have a long field. They have to go 80 yards.
Well, at times against Missouri last week, Nebraska didn't seem like they covered anybody. Nebraska coaching staff was concerned about that. At times today, there have been guys wide open. Iowa State's made him pay for it only once. Davis is going to be popped. Doesn't get back to the line of scrimmage, and a penalty flag is going to be thrown in the secondary. I think it was Damon Green was really doing battle in the secondary with number 25, Joe Walker, the freshman out of Arlington, Texas. Maybe a personal foul on one of the two of those. Here is Walker. 20 total tackles this year. He's got a sack.
Yeah, substitution infraction on the defense.
They didn't have 12 men on the field, but they must have run a player in late from the sideline. Tom Osborne's not real happy about that.
Rick Neuheisel knows something about that.
But, boy, this Nebraska football team is powerful. I mean, it's a combination. Everything you'd want in a football team, strength, speed, quickness. They've got it all. They've got the total package. They run the football so well. Scott Frost is more than competent throwing the football, as he showed against Missouri when their backs were to the wall. This football team has so many weapons.
Charlie McBride telling us yesterday, the defensive coordinator, that Jason Peter and Grant Wistrom have made it known what they wanted to do today. They're doing just that. The reverse. They have some blockers. Green to the 30, up to the 34-yard line before he is shoved out of bounds. Joe Walker is the one who shoved him. Let's take a look at the left side of that line.
Take a look at what Iowa State's trying to get done here. Kurt Lovezzo, the big right tackle, blocks down. And then they release late. Lovezzo is the one that's going to get out in front and throw the key block for Green. Look at Lovezzo working on a smaller player. Just gets enough of a piece of him to allow Green to get extra yards down the field. That's a nice effort, second effort down the football field by the big guy.
Sun breaks through here in Lincoln. Darren Davis trying to break through, and he's not going to get to the 30-yard line. He is going to be pushed back.
That is a multiple tackle for loss.
Yeah, Kyle Vandenbosch, a freshman out of Iowa, and Brian Shaw, the linebacker, number 46. There's Vandenbosch, number 83, 6'4", 235 pounds.
And I think you're going to see Wistrom taking a little bit of a break here in this football game. He's beaten up a little bit. Wistrom and Peter are both both fighting through some injuries. Wistrom's got a couple of dislocated fingers and a thigh injury, and Peter's got a little bit of a back problem, although you'd never know it today.
Penalty flags thrown, everybody dancing around on the inside. Number 99, Jason Wiltz, the junior out of New Orleans, is the one I think who might have made contact.
And it's really a problem when he makes the contact. The ball's right under his nose. Move when the ball moves, not when the quarterback
offside.
Says.
Defense, 5-yard penalty.
That's the call.
Now what happens is the quarterback does the non-rhythmic cadence and gives you the hard count, tries to get you jumpy. Instead of like a rhythmic hut, 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 he gives it the hut, hut, and then the third hut and gets you jumping, and that's what happens. You can't listen to the quarterback. As a down lineman, particularly nose guard, you move when the football moves. If they're too jumpy inside.
I remember you told me when you were a center, you used to squeeze the ball.
Right.
Guys that think you're going to snap it.
Yep.
Oh, Bandauer, quick looking. Patton almost intercepted. Watley heard the footsteps. He looked up as the ball was coming to him, and he saw a bunch of red jerseys, and he kind of just ducked out of the way.
Boy, Jason Peter and Kyle Vandenbosch kind of met at the quarterback a little bit. Peter hits him in the back again. I'm telling you, Bandauer, he's going to have to put a neck brace on. He's going to have whiplash after this game. He's getting hit from behind so much. Jason Peter already with four quarterback hurries today. Actually blows Bandauer up. And then the deflection off of Watley. Brown almost takes it the other way. Almost a big takeaway. Nebraska, only six interceptions all year, Ron. That's a problem. Usually they're up in the 20s.
The low snap. Bandauer throws it incomplete, intended for Ed Williams. Williams, again, though, was open. Todd Bandauer just not getting him the football. But I tell you what, I have seen a couple of times today, Dave, that the Iowa State receivers are starting to do a couple of baby steps when they see that secondary closing on them.
Yeah, and if you give Bandauer just an extra half a second to throw the football. But this Nebraska defensive unit, Ron, only six interceptions. Last year, they had 23. So and all the interceptions are by the secondary. No linebacker interceptions yet. Charlie McBride would like to see that turnaround today.
Bobby Newcomb set to return the kick. Carl Gomez gets it away. It's going to be a short kick. Newcomb.
Oh.
Again, he's hit, and that'll be another penalty. The third time today, Iowa State has done that.
Come on. And Wilson, now he's saying, you know, what am I doing? Well, you have to make the adjustment before the play, not after the play.
Well, a penalty will be on Iowa State with 12:29 left in the first half. 42-7 is our score. We'll return to Memorial Stadium after this word from Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Well, Nebraska averaging 13 yards per play on offense. They have over 230 total yards right now. Their average time of possession for each score, about a minute and eight. So they have six touchdowns. 42-7, Scott Frost and company putting the chill on Iowa State.
Look at the splits Nebraska's taking up front. The line splits are huge.
Straight up the middle. Let's take a look at that last putt and see exactly what happened.
Well, Kevin Wilson is the kill guy, the cover guy in the white jersey. You won't see him yet until the ball's in the air. And the ball's punted. Kevin Wilson, number 25, the white jersey, is nudge. But he's not even trying to break down. I mean, he just blows Newcomb up, and then Dan McCartney blows up Wilson. He says, what are you doing? Clean it up. You know, loose translation. What are you doing, son? How many times are you going to make the same mistake? Come on, you're a smarter guy than that. Something like that.
Boy, did you have poetic license on that one.
Yeah.
I got a funny feeling that's not exactly what he said. Scott Frost is going to keep it. He stood up as he crosses the 40. Not before he picks up 4 yards on the play. 11:39 left in the first half. Preston Ramey on the stop, number 32, the senior out of Dallas, Texas, a former walk-on. They call this guy a player that has all heart.
Yeah, he's a kamikaze pilot. I mean, look at his decals already floating right there. He stripped his decal almost off his helmet. It's sticking up out of there from that contact.
It's good.
He's just waving in the wind. He's got that cyclone just kind of cruising out there.
He's got little wings there, huh?
Yeah.
Third and one. The pitch, the first down, and then some. Correll Buchholder, a freshman out of Collins, Nebraska, 6'2", 210. They've got a couple of young running backs on this Nebraska team. Along with Buchholder, they have Dan Alexander, a freshman out of Wentzville, Missouri. He's 6'2", 250. Between Buchholder and Alexander, they got a couple of powerhouse future stars on this team.
Well, Ron, Nebraska never rebuilds. They just retool. I mean, they have all kinds of weapons. It's almost like interchangeable drill bits. They just put a different one in, and it just does the job for you.
I like that. A little Black and Decker analogy. Oh, we'll get it all in today, folks. On the swing pass, barely getting back to the line of scrimmage, and you can hear the pads popping all the way up here. Buchholder taking goal on the hit, I should say. Makovicus. Reggie Hayward on the stop. Well, Nebraska has rushed for over 220 yards already today.
Boy, it's going to... They may rush for four football fields today. They've rushed for over 400 yards four times this year, and they're well on track to do it again.
Well, they've won 83 straight when they rushed for 300. This time, Not much running room for Buckhalter. Buckhalter came in averaging just under 6 yards a carry. He has 6 rushing touchdowns on the year. Michael Cooper, number 38 on the stop.
Well, you know, Ron, I think when I was talking about Nebraska just retooling, not rebuilding, it's due to the coaching staff. They've got that continuity in the staff. They go out recruiting, and the kids know exactly who these coaches are. They want to come to Nebraska. Their tradition just continues to roll, and they maintain that level of excellence year after year after year.
On third down, Nebraska 2 of 2 on third down conversions. Make it 3 of 3, Scott Frost.
Amazing.
Carried by Scott Frost.
He is better suited for an I-back. He's 6'3", 220, folks. He is not some small little option quarterback.
No, and he started at safety for Stanford. When he went to Stanford, he initially went as a quarterback. They had to get him on the football field. This is a design play, a quarterback basically counterplay. The offensive line pulls up in front. They get a nice kickout block, and Scott Frost is off to the races. I mean, with him at quarterback, you have to defend him just like you do a running back. You have to account for him in the running game, and it makes it tough for the defense to outnumber Nebraska's offense.
Closing in on becoming the all-time rushing quarterback at Nebraska. Frost has time. Pass is complete to Cheatham. Cheatham inside the 10, down to the 6-yard line.
Complete to number 6.
Cheatham had a career day last week against Missouri. 5 catches for 54 yards, courtesy Scott Frost, and a couple of them were in that big drive to tie it up at the end of the football game. Kenny Cheatham was large last week.
10 catches, ties for the team lead. That doesn't sound like a whole lot, but you have to understand that 16 different players have caught the football for Nebraska this year.
The wide receiver core as a group, though, they block downfield better than any receiver core in football. They knock people down.
First and goal. Straight up the middle, Billy Legate, the fullback.
Ball carried number 40.
You know, and you look down there sometimes, Ron, I've seen plays already today where 5 or 6 Cyclones are on the turf. Nebraska gets so many knockdowns, tremendous number of knockdowns.
Well, you know, the Nebraska was talking about their offensive line yesterday, that if you get a hat on somebody as far as the offensive line, you're going to get 4 or 5 yards. And Turner Gill was telling us, a lot of people say, wait, 4 yards isn't a whole lot, but that's exactly what Nebraska wants.
Oh, you're right on schedule. When you're 2nd and 6, 2nd and 5, and you can run the option, you've got the defense on their heels.
2nd and goal from the 2. Already leading 42-7.
Oh, McAvicka. Or not even McAvicka. That's the backup fullback.
Buckhalter gets down to about the 1-yard line. Cooper tripped him up, or he had golden goalposts again.
Billy Legate, what a block. These fullbacks, everybody does things fundamentally sound here at Nebraska. I mean, they are a training reel. McAvicka out, Legate comes in. He knocks his guy down. He gets a pancake. You know, when Nebraska's on a roll, Ron, if they run 70 plays in a game, they get 100 pancakes out of the various positions.
Right up the middle. Touchdown, Nebraska. Scott Frost did it.
Too much of a surge by the offensive line. Iowa State just couldn't hold up to that powerful red tide.
Well, with that rush, Scott Frost has tied the school record for rushing yards by a quarterback. 925 yards, 15 touchdowns.
Wow.
That record dates back to 1989. Chris Brown, 47 for 47 coming into the game, and he's been perfect today. Ted Retzlaff on the hole. Chris Brown has 10 straight consecutive field goals. He's an excellent kicker. He's one of those fun guys you like talking to yesterday. Ball's down, kicks through. Chris Brown remains perfect on the year, and Nebraska is perfect on the afternoon. 7:53 left in the half. They lead by a bunch. 7, Scott Frost takes it in from about the 1-yard line.
Is he related to Jack? It's getting cold out here.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah.
His 15th rushing touchdown of the year. Tyrell Watley looking for the Iowa State record. He has some yardage. Penalty flag is going to be thrown as he crosses the 15 up to the 17-yard line. 11 yards, 16 yards on the return.
You got an illegal block in the back. It's going to cost Iowa State. This is where you get a holding call. This is where the team speed shows up. Nebraska's team speed is so much more dramatic than what Iowa State can present. It shows up on special teams. I mean, the third team, fourth team players from Nebraska run faster than some starters or second team guys for Iowa State.
Holding. Receiving team, half the distance to the goal. First down.
Seventh penalty on Iowa State this afternoon.
This might, the holding call might have been on 25, Kevin Wilson. I was a little brush in the back there. I think that it could, there were about two or three areas where they could have possibly called the hold. The hold is right there. Yeah, the hold took place right with Preston Rainey's the one that grabbed and tried to take a Nebraska player to the turf. Can't do that.
First and 10, ball on the 9-yard line for Iowa State. Maybe getting up to the 10-yard line. Jay Foreman, father Chuck Foreman, former NFL great, on the stop.
He was a great. When I played against Chuck Foreman when he played college ball at Miami, Florida, and then in the NFL with the Minnesota Vikings, and Chuck Foreman could do it. Double fours, number 44, Chuck Foreman could play.
And, you know, Jay Foreman was the only linebacker at the beginning of this year with any type of major playing experience, and they were a little concerned about their linebacking core, but Johnson, Polk, and Ortiz have really stepped up along with Brian Shaw.
Yeah, Charlie McBride thinks they have six to complain on.
Handauer has time. Penalty flag is thrown. The ball is loose. Nebraska will get it. Chad Kelsey picks it up, rambles his way down to the five. We have a penalty flag, and I think it's going to be on Iowa State anyway.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a hold on Iowa State. There's a feeding frenzy going on right now. The black shirts are just feeding.
Holding on the offense. Penalty is declined. First down.
Well, Jason Wiltz is the one who forced the fumble, the junior out of New Orleans. Watch number 99. I think that's the guy who got the hand on it.
Now, this is a coverage play because Bandauer's got time to throw this football. He little play action fake, steps up in the pocket. He has to pump fake, nowhere to go. Then finally from behind, he's stripped by Allen. Kelsey kicks it around a little bit, and then he secures the football. Tremendous play right there by the everybody in the defense. Allen inside, Kelsey in the outside, and the coverage people because Bandauer had nowhere to go with the football.
Derek Allen, number 95, the sophomore out of Russellville, Arkansas. Frost going to put it up. Looks over the middle, wide open, touchdown Nebraska.
Man.
Sheldon Jackson, the junior out of Diamond Bar, California. Second touchdown reception of the year. All set up by that man.
Yep, Allen's the guy that started the whole thing by a little tomahawk chop, a little strip of the quarterback from behind. Kelsey, his teammate, recovers, and then Nebraska goes right for the jugular. I mean, a one-play drive right after that. Might as well get one of the tight ends involved.
Man, why not?
That's exactly what they do. Get Sheldon Jackson the football.
Scott Frost, 5 of 6 throw of the football, 55 yards and a touchdown. Ted Retzlaff's going to get a chance to kick. The senior from Waverly, Nebraska, playing in his last game. One of 23 seniors saying goodbye to the hometown fans today.
Senior day is a big day here at Nebraska, and the Cornhuskers are responding. Little play action fake. Scott Frost rolls out of the pocket, throws back across his body. Tremendous arm strength because there's decent coverage there. You know, DeJuan Anderson is right in the vicinity, but Jackson just takes it away from him. Good throw by Scott Frost across his body, showing great arm strength. You know, Scott Frost was the Nebraska State shot put champion. The runner-up is his right tackle, Eric Anderson, the All-American. Scott Frost was the number one shot putter in high school as a high school track and field athlete. That's incredible.
Let's take a look at our Southwest Airlines game summary. Well, 35 first quarter points ties a Nebraska school record. Iowa State, negative yardage rushing the football. Amon Green over 100. He scored 3 times. Jason Peters had a whale of a day. 3 tackles, a couple of quarterback hurries, and a fumble recovery.
I think the rushing yards, -3 to 252, tells you who's winning the battle at the line of scrimmage and ultimately the war. Nebraska is dominating both sides of the line of scrimmage. Offensive and defensive lines are just kicking it strong.
Well, we thought because they dropped in the polls that they want to hang a bunch of points on today. Not that Tom Osborne wants to, but they'd have to in order to try to move up on the polls. Watley again, slipping through some tackles. He is hit hard. Still standing at the 15-yard line. But boy, he took some upside of the head.
Some tremendous speed and contact on the kickoff coverage team.
Let's take a look at Bobby Newcomb. Has a touchdown rushing, catching, and returning this year.
Yeah, here's the punt return. He does a good job. There's a penalty on this. His halo was interfered with, but he's an angel. He's taking it to the end zone anyway. I mean, there's no chance for the punter to make the play, the tackle on him in the open field. Then the option. So his all-purpose yards, he's over the century mark in terms of kick return, punt return, as well as his touchdown on the option. This kid, every touch of the football is about a first down and a half, about 15 yards every time he gets hands on it.
He's had a heavenly day today.
Yes.
6:37 left in the first half, 56-7.
Ooh.
Ball is batted down. It may have been Steve Warren, number 96, the big sophomore
right.
from Springfield, Missouri.
Yep. And he's not, this isn't, this is a guy that body type wise may not be the biggest animal on the field, but he's a guy that realizes when you can't get to the quarterback, you get your hands up. And if he's throwing in your rush lane, you can bat that ball down. That's exactly what he did.
Nebraska 56-3 over the past 5 years. That's an NCAA best mark. They lead it 56-7 now. Davis is going to be crushed.
Ball carry by Darren Davis.
Clint Finley in on the stop. Chad Kelsey also there to help him out. Number 57. Kelsey coming from that line, from the line spot. He got him from behind.
It's one of those things where right now you're facing such a deficit. Game plans have already come flying out of the coach's box.
Yeah.
I mean, you wanted to be balanced, but now you have to fire and fall back every single play. And this is playing just right into Nebraska's goal going into this football game, was to make Iowa State one-dimensional.
Well, the sun has come out. Bandauer in the flat to Davis. To the 30, cuts back.
Oh,
nice spin move.
Man.
Oh, my, that was quick up to the 37-yard line. Eric Johnson runs him out of bounds. We saw Davis make a catch last year against Texas A&M that was just short of spectacular. He's got some moves and some hands.
Take a look at the matchup. Wisdom working against a guy that feels like he has a shot to play in the NFL, Oliver Ross. Decent pass protection by Ross on Wisdom that time, giving Bandauer an opportunity to get the ball to Davis. And if I tried that spin move that Darren Davis just executed, there'd be an anterior cruciate ligament at about the 35-yard line. No way.
And maybe your breakfast there, too.
Yeah, easily.
5:46, first and 10. We're in the second quarter. Bandauer hit as he throws. Pass is going to be incomplete. Green out of bounds when he made the catch. Chad Kelsey lowered the boom again on Bandauer.
Bandauer has been picking himself up off the turf a high percentage of the time. I mean, he hasn't been sacked all that regularly, but he has been hit a ton. I'd say 70% of his passes, he's ended up on his backside. Little play-action fake, and Kelsey just hits him right in the solar plexus. I mean, drives right through him. As a result, he has to throw the football a little sooner than he thought, and Green cannot get either foot down in bounds, hence the incompletion.
Kelsey, four quarterback hurries already this afternoon. Sets up a second and 10, ball on the 38 for the Cyclones. Nebraska moving around on the line of scrimmage. Davis, ooh, takes a big hit as he crosses the 45 up to the 47-yard line. Will be maybe about a half a yard short. Brandon Quint on the stop. Penn State leading Purdue, 14-9. That's in the third. Florida State all over Wake Forest. West Virginia 31-7 on top of Temple. That is also in the third. Ohio State blanking Illinois at halftime.
Ooh,
Florida and South Carolina in a battle.
Good battle.
Iowa by a touchdown over Northwestern. And Mississippi State's taking the advantage over Alabama. That is in the second. Third down and a yard for Iowa State. Ooh, Davis not going to get it.
Nope.
He is going to be driven back.
Ortiz says no goal. No. Man, this another kid. That's another linebacker Ortiz run that can run 10-5, 10-6 hundred meters. I mean, that's running back speed that Nebraska enjoys at the linebacker level. They've got gifted athletes that can really fly.
Yeah. And Iowa State will be forced to punt it again.
A lot of these linebackers did play running back in high school.
Nebraska yet to punt. Lance Brown, number 14, two returns already this year, averages 10.5. His longest was 15 yards. End over end kick. Brown's going to let it bounce.
And Nebraska will be backed up as it rolls out of bounds at about the 12-yard line. A 37-yard kick, no return. And with 4:06 left to play in the half, a 56-7 ball game. All Nebraska, one of three undefeated teams, still with hopes of that national championship. Have their eyes set on San Antonio for December 6th. Big 12 championship game against either A&M or Oklahoma State. Hopefully a shot at the Orange Bowl and their third national title in 4 years.
I think that the only Achilles heel that Nebraska may face in a bowl game against somebody that can throw the football and pass protect is that young secondary being challenged.
Frost on the option. Nice pitch. Green crossing the 20, dancing down the sidelines. They're going to mark it out at about the 23-yard line. Pickup of about 11. Now, the bowl game situation usually right about now is clear. This is tentative. Florida State, Nebraska in the orange. Ohio State not out of that Rose Bowl picture, though, Dave.
No, if they finish, if Ohio State somehow finishes second in the country going into the bowls, all bets are off on tiebreakers. Even though they went last year, they could go back to the Rose Bowl, but that's far from happening now.
Of course, the Cotton Bowl will also have a Big 12 team along with the Alamo Bowl. Cotton Bowl either be Kansas State, looks like. A&M in the picture on that. Green on the carry. Cooper on the stop. And, of course, Texas Tech saying they're not going to go to a bowl. That is unfortunate, but I tell you, our hat is off for Spike Dykes and everybody in Lubbock, the way they've handled that situation. They've done it with a lot of dignity.
They have. They've continued to play hard. I mean, his football team goes out there and performs for Spike Dykes and his coaching staff every snap.
Nobody's left the stadium. 220th consecutive sellout. Frost, first down, crossing the 40 up to the 46-yard line. Finally being tackled by Kevin Hudson.
Well, Scott Frost is so much improved in the option game in the two areas we've talked about. Decision-making and accuracy of the pitch. It's just like if you're throwing a football down the field. Lead your pitch back. Get the pitch out there in front of him in full stride. Don't make him stop. Don't throw it behind him. The accuracy of Scott Frost's pitch and his decision-making, whether to pitch or run, is extraordinary.
Well, that pickup gives Frost 86 yards rushing the football today, and he is now the all-time rushing quarterback in Nebraska history. And his pass is going to be complete up to the 35-yard line. Number 88, Sheldon Jackson, the tight end, his second reception on the year, on the day.
And Scott Frost is more than adequate throwing the football. He's got a little bit of a funny motion. He's got kind of like a push motion when he throws the football a little bit. Little misdirection play. Pushes that ball. You know, it comes over the top. It has a push to it a little bit, but he's accurate enough with it, and he showed against Missouri that when he has to throw the football to come back with the tying touchdown, he can get that done very well.
He was the Big 12 newcomer of the year last year. Green, right side, has a blocker in front of him. Pads are popping. Inside the 30, down to the 28-yard line, DeJuan Anderson on the stop, number 14 for Iowa State.
You know, the record holder for the junior year in terms of yards at the quarterback position is Scott Frost.
Yeah.
And think of Tommy Frazier and all the other great quarterbacks that have played here. The guy in his junior year that accumulated more yards than anybody at quarterback is that young man, Scott Frost, right there. So this guy's a very, very gifted athlete, and he's playing even a higher level this year.
Nebraska closing in on 300 yards rushing the football in the first half, and they may have had it on that play. Joel Makovica, the former walk-on. Right up the middle, Cooper on the stop. Tom Osborne gave him a great compliment, said he is probably the best fullback outside of Tom Rathman he sees.
And Makovica, I love him. I mean, this guy, look at the offensive line pushing their people past the play, and Makovica hits it with authority. I mean, Makovica is going north and south, his shoulder pads square. He's got a low center of gravity. In football's a game of physics. Low pads win. Makovica's pads, you have to basically get on your kneecaps to get under his pads, and he'll thump you. He's smiling. He loves that contact.
Yeah.
He says, hit me again. I love this stuff.
He came into the game two touchdowns short of a record for touchdowns for a fullback. Pass is complete to Lake. And once again, Nebraska knocking on the door. They're going to take the door off the hinges by the time this game's over.
Yeah, they're kicking the door. They're kicking it, knocking it. They're beating the heck out of the door, and they're in rhythm run. I mean, I don't know how Iowa State can get this machine out of rhythm because Nebraska's in full rhythm right now. If you go against a great pitcher, you step out of the box, you try to change the rhythm up on the pitcher a little bit, I don't think Iowa State can get Nebraska out of rhythm here in the first half.
Frost threw for 175 yards last week. Having a nice game this week, and he's directing an attack that's just crushing Nebraska, or Iowa State, straight up the middle.
Well, now Nebraska ends up lining up in that power eye formation. They have a couple of lead blockers for the tailback, and they have so many good blockers at the fullback position. That's a good move. Load them up between the hash marks, get extra backs, extra tight ends in there, and just thrash them, maul them at the line of scrimmage.
Nebraska in the red zone. 44 touchdowns, 62 opportunities, 53 out of 62 total.
That's pretty good touchdown ratio there in the red zone.
Makavica looking for the record. Already has one touchdown today. He's going to be short. That'll bring up a third down situation for the Cornhuskers. Final 25 seconds. Let's see if Tom Osborne goes for it and lets the clock run out. Fans want him to go for it. Final 20 seconds of the quarter. Nebraska. 63 points you saw, excuse me, Dave, is the record for a half. Nebraska has a chance to get it. They got it.
They came up to the line of scrimmage. They up-tempoed it, Ron, and they ran the quarterback sneak before Iowa State could even get their defense set. And Nebraska's offensive line, their surge was incredible. It's like trying to stop the red tide. The red tide just keeps rolling and rolling to the beach. Now, this is a quick snap. They came out of the huddle quick. Iowa State's not even set. Their shoulder pads are high. And, boy, those red jerseys, that wall, that line of scrimmage is reestablished 4 yards into the end zone. They knocked them back big time.
Well, Ted Retzlaff, the senior from Waverly, Nebraska, the senior, the left-footed kicker to attempt the extra point, giving the senior some playing time.
His extra point is good,
and Nebraska has tied their record for most points at a half. 63-7 is our halftime score. 5 seconds left to play in the opening half.
Charles Dickens' novel, Tale of Two Cities. Well, it was a tale of two football games in one last week, and Iowa State can only hope that the second half will be a little bit different than the first one here today so far.
Watley needs 10 yards. He's got that, and then some. Look out, Tyron Watley. Run out of bounds as time runs out. Gets up to the 36-yard line. That is the yardage on the return. He gets all his yardage in the first half, but it has been all Nebraska. 63-7. What a first half for Scott Frost, Dave.
Scott Frost was incredible. 8 rushes, 88 yards, a couple of touchdowns. He was 7 for 8 in the air for 89 yards and a touchdown. 15 times throwing in, catching, throwing in, running the football for 177 yards and 3 touchdowns.
Here's Jim Knox.
All right, one of the happiest men has to be right here, Coach Tom Osborne. You're putting on quite a clinic, close to 400 total yards. You're only giving up 14 yards rushing. Got to be extremely pleased.
Well, I think our players were ready to play today. They played hard, and really sorry about that last touchdown. We were hoping we could just run a sneak and not even get in the end zone, but they didn't get lined up, so we put it in. But we've played well, and we're pleased with the execution.
A lot of walk-ons and backups. I'm sure we'll get a lot of action in the second.
Everybody's going to get to play, and that's the nice thing about a game like this. You get a lot of people in the last home game.
Okay, thanks, Coach. Okay. All right, looks like, Ron, I could even suit up maybe in the second half.
I don't know. Our producer, Bob Steinfeld, is talking about how he can run through some of the holes. Maybe we can let him go down there and see, huh? Line him up. We're at halftime. Nebraska leads it by a bundle. .400 yards in the first half, lead 63-7, and they will receive the kickoff to begin the third quarter of play. It's going to be Shevin Wiggins from the 5. Hit hard as he crosses the 20 up to the 22-yard line. 16 yards on the return as we take a look at our Citgo halftime statistics. Dave, look at those rushing yards.
Yep, that's the ball game right there. On Nebraska, on 31 carries, 305 yards, almost 10 yards a pop. And Iowa State turning the football over a couple of times. You can't have that. They had gone 10 quarters without giving the football up, but give it up 2 times to Nebraska. Iowa State punted 6 times in the first half. Nebraska did not punt at all.
They'll keep it on the ground, straight up the middle. A big hole again for Amon Green.
Nebraska has won 83 straight games when they rush for 300. Not bad. They're way over that now. They're 83-0 when they rush for 400.
And this is why Nebraska has not punted the football. The offensive line, excellent trap, little counterplay. Big Eric Anderson gets down the field and gets a block. And Nebraska has run anything they've wanted to run successfully because of the offensive line.
The fullback, Makavica, picks up a couple of yards. You know, one thing, as we talk about the Nebraska offense, they've been with this offense so long, they can make adjustments so quickly, no matter what defense you throw at them. You talked about the 10 different formations, but their adjustments come quickly.
And that's because of the experience together, Ron, and the coaching staff. When you've got four coaches that have worked together for over 20 years, you know, they go back and say, well, 5 years ago, Missouri did this to us, and here's how we adjusted. That's a huge advantage when you have that continuity, that you have a historical reference point.
On second and six, Frost keeps it, floats it up, pass is complete. Upended at the 42-yard line, the ball is down. Let's see what they say. They're saying Iowa State's got it. It was complete to Jackson. He just couldn't hold on.
Yep, and coming up with the football is Birchka. I think it might have been knocked loose out there by Densmore. Birchka came up with it. Just a tremendous hit delivered. The ball stripped. Actually, the ball is stripped from behind before that initial hit by Josh Yates. Was it Yates? Who was it that hit him from? You know, Hudson hit him from behind.
Yeah.
And Birchka came up with the football.
Against Missouri, Nebraska was -2 as far as turnovers. Iowa State still trying to establish a running game, trying that right side of their offensive line. Following behind the blots of Lovetso, Baudette, Eric Johnson, and Jason Wilson on the stop. There's big number 70, Ben Baudette, redshirt freshman out of Stillwater, Minnesota. Not a very good, he never really pass blocked in high school. That's been a problem, but they still think this young man's going to be very, very good. 7-0. Pickup of 3 on the play, 2nd and 7 for Iowa State. Have not beaten Nebraska here in Lincoln since 1977. Swing it out to Davis. Stays on his feet, close to the first down. Did a nice job putting that hand down so he can keep his balance. He may be about a half a yard short, Jay Foreman, on the stop.
Now, this kid has got tremendous balance, like we mentioned, from wrestling. His brother Troy and Darren Davis, both state champions in wrestling in high school, the state of Florida, as well as football. Look at the hit and then the balance, as you mentioned, Ron, getting that hand down as to form the tripod to keep his balance. And think about the toughness of this kid. He's got a real bad thigh problem, a Charlie horse. In this cold weather, can't get it loose and taking hit after hit on that thing. He's tough.
Third down and less than a yard for Iowa State. Davis, the lone setback. He goes in motion. Bandauer keeps it. He'll have the first down. You know, one thing that Iowa State did, they had a lot of plays in the first half. They had over 40 plays for Dan McCarty and company. Nebraska, all 9 opponents have had 66 plays or less. So Iowa State has actually run a lot of plays. They just haven't been effective.
No, exactly. I mean, Nebraska has handled just about everything Iowa State has thrown at them. The one amazing statistic for the Nebraska football team, or one of many, as Steve Loney tries to figure out what the heck to call here to sustain this drive and execute and score a touchdown to close the gap. They get a fresh set of 4, but this Nebraska team defensively is amazing.
Bandauer lets it fly down the sideline, had a man, no penalty flag, pass is incomplete. Ralph Brown on the coverage, number 22, the sophomore out of Hacienda Heights, California.
Tom Osborne has done a lot of things with this Nebraska football team. One statistic that amazes me, they've only been in the negative category in turnover ratio one time in 25 years under Tom Osborne. That was in 1984. They were -5. Every other year, they've been in the plus category in the turnover department. And when you're plus category that frequently, you're going to win a lot of games, and they do.
Tom looking for his 5th consecutive 11-win season. Bandauer's pass is picked off. Intercepted by number 21, Mike Brown.
That's the 7th interception of the year.
And we have a penalty flag thrown.
See, if he went through the receiver to make the interception, that the interception is going to be nullified.
They're going to talk it over. That was a pretty good-looking play by Mike Brown, his first interception.
Picking it up.
Disregard the flag. It was an interception.
That's a good call. It was an interception. And that's the seventh pick of the year. Like I said before, normally at this time of the year, Nebraska is approaching 20 interceptions, but they do get number seven here on the blitz. Brown does a good job. He jumps the route, good route recognition, comes up with the football. Bandauer said, hey, wait now. He went through my receiver to make a play on that football. What are you doing? There you see the flag coming in. The officials decide to pick it up, though.
That was only the eighth interception thrown by Bandauer this year. Nebraska will keep it on the ground in a big hole into Iowa State territory again. James Reed, a redshirt freshman, number 52, and Preston Ramey finally slowing Amon Green down.
Nebraska doing everything right today. Their offense gives the football up by fumble. Right away, the defense responds and takes it right back with an interception. Substitution, Scott Frost out of the game. Here comes some wholesale subs for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
Well, Frankie London has now come in at quarterback. The sophomore out of Lake Charles, Louisiana. Some feel this kid is going to be a great quarterback. Slips and falls, may have gotten the first down. Amon Green last year had 214 yards rushing versus Iowa State. Look at the numbers on London this year. He has 163 yards today for Amon Green.
Over 6 yards a pop for London. Scott Frost over 6 yards a pop. Amon Green over 6 yards a pop. Why? Because the offensive line establishes themselves up front. They dominate the line of scrimmage. Another more than productive day for Scott Frost. He was just about flawless out there.
88 yards rushing the football for Scott Frost. Passing. About 111 yards. Green. Right side. Big hole. Look out. Touchback. Again. He's got the ball close in sight. Flipped up at the two.
What an effort down the football field by Rashawn Jackson, the tight end. The downfield blocking by Rashawn Jackson was incredible. He stayed after his guy. He must have blocked his defender two or three times. Let's take a look as Green breaks this. Look, when we get down the football field, watch 34 in the red jersey. Right here, sustain the block. Green cuts back, he picks him up again. I mean, that's just great downfield blocking. That's why Nebraska, when they break it, it goes the distance because of what they do down the field and what the running backs see down the field.
Over 200 yards rushing the football for Amon Green today. Nebraska, Frankie Lovell loses the football. Still loose. Iowa State's got a shot at it. They come up with it at the 22-yard line.
The man that stripped it came up with it. That's a big, big play for Kip King. He knocked it free, and then he stayed after it and recovered it. That's a huge play. Forced fumble and recovered fumble by the same guy. London trying to run the option down the line of scrimmage, reverse pivots. Kip King from behind. Tomahawk chop, ball out of there. And Kip King gets off the turf now. It bounces around. Kip King gets after it. He's the one that picks it up. That's incredible hustle on the same play to force the fumble and recover it 15 yards down the field by the same player. Good effort.
First and 10 for Iowa State. They've thrown an interception. They've recovered a fumble here in the second half. Davis falls forward to the 25-yard line. Aaron Davis finding the going tough. Prior to that, he had 14 carries for just 31 yards.
Boy, how about Nebraska, though? They come out here to start the third quarter and back-to-back turnovers. Fumble on their first two possessions. See if the defense can respond. The last time the offense turned it over, the defense got it right back with an interception by Brown. Let's see how this one goes.
The numbers on Darren Davis.
Had to work hard for those 33 yards.
I'll tell you, hurt in the first half versus Colorado. Tried to come back in the second half. Oh. No avail. That is a stick. Joe Parmentier gets leveled by Mike Brown.
Oh, baby. Check the dentures. Make sure that all those fillings are in there nice and tight. Mike Brown tried to loosen a couple of them. Let's listen to see what a heat-seeking missile sounds like once it makes contact. Helmet to shoulder pads here. It's a shot. It's a real shot. Good effort.
Joe Parmentier went off the field limping.
I don't blame him. I'd have a hitch you might get along if you blew me up like that, too.
Oh, I tell you, Mike Brown leading the team, 6.6 tackles a game, 3rd and 8 now for Iowa State. 6 for 13 on third down conversion. Bandauer gets hit, is going to be dropped.
Johnson, the junior from Phoenix.
What an effort by Johnson, because he was cut to the turf, and he only stayed down there for a millisecond, and he got right back up and still made the quarterback sack. It was to Bandauer's blind side. Johnson, extreme athleticism. I mean, he wasn't on the ground long enough to even feel what the turf was like. He comes on the blitz. Davis does a good job, cuts him. He never even really goes down. He just scrambles. He goes and gets his balance with both his hands and just crawls right to the quarterback. Outstanding effort by a great athlete.
Carl Gomez kicking with the wind. Bobby Newcomb's already returned one. Whistle penalty flag.
Ball start again by Iowa State. Somebody moving a little too soon up front, it looked like.
That was the third sack of the year by Eric Johnson, by the way.
Dead ball. Ball start. Offense.
Well, Nebraska's defense responding to the offense stammering a little bit and stuttering, fumbling the football. What'd they do? Well, on one of those fumbles, they took it back with an interception. The next time, they knocked Iowa State backwards. So they're going to give their offense good field position again with a short field to work with. So the defense responding here in the second half, big time.
We'll try it again. Newcomb standing at the Iowa State 45-yard line. Gomez gets a good kick out of the way, backing up Newcomb. Stops, heads the other way. He's got some blocking. Going to be tripped up as he nears the 50. Going to be dropped back at the 46-yard line, a 47-yard punt. 9 on the return. 63-7 is our score. Artwork in front of it was a torn notebook. That's probably what Dan McCartney did at halftime, tore his game plan in half and just said, we got to throw it away.
Absolutely. Redo that bad boy. Halftime adjustments, too many to make.
Too many. Frankie London's the quarterback. Scott Frost is sitting down. We got a bunch of new players in now for Nebraska. Jay Sims, a senior from Omaha, Nebraska, 6'1", 220 on the carry. Sims, his 16th carry on the year. You know, talking about Amon Green, number 30, who has been replaced by Jay Sims, he likes Iowa State. He has, as of today, almost 600 yards rushing against him in the last 3 years, 10.69 average, 8 touchdowns. He's probably sad to go out.
He really is, and in the first half, he averaged over 11 yards a carry, even to improve on that. So, yeah, when he sees Iowa State, he sees yards.
Penalty flag is going to be thrown. London steps away from the pressure. Being chased, and he is going to be run out of bounds at the 46. That may have been a free play for Nebraska. Iowa State jumping off sides.
Greg Schoen is the one that jumped into the neutral zone. He tried to anticipate that snap count. You can't move based on the quarterback's voice.
Defense.
Schoen has to look at that football. When the football moves, you move, big fella, not before.
Yeah, we talked about how he's the biggest of the linemen and had to play big today. He's had his hands full.
Yeah, Nebraska's offensive line has engulfed Iowa State's defensive front seven.
Ninth penalty against Iowa State today. You know, one thing about the Nebraska offense, we talked about the fact that, you know, they've got this continuity, but their terminology offensively, because their assistant coaches have all been here such a long time, they don't have to spend a whole lot of time teaching the coaches the terminology of their offense.
Yeah, and on the sideline run, they communicate adjustments so quickly because of the terminology. It's like football shorthand, and they all understand it.
London's going to keep it. London is going to be dropped.
Ball carried by London.
Greg Schoen on the stop. Well, you talk about coaching staffs. Joe Paterno with Penn State, with Fran and Ganner.
Yep.
Obviously, Bobby Bowden out of Florida State. But how about the loyal lieutenants here at Nebraska?
Look at that. Three of them have been here between 21 and 25 years. Frank Solich next year, will hit the 20-year mark. Dan Young, 15. That's incredible, because all of these guys have turned down bigger opportunities as coordinators or in the pro ranks, and that continuity has kept them in the top five year after year.
At second and seven, London keeps it close to the first down. That's 152 years combined experience.
Well, you know, Ron, we were talking about it the other day. Florida State, Penn State, Nebraska, what do they have in common? They've got a bunch of coaches that like each other and have stayed around together for a number of years, and that breeds success. Southern Cal, Notre Dame, Alabama, all these high-profile programs are down this year. Why? A turnover in the coaching staff,
non-continuity and adjustments that it takes to get it rerouted. There's no turnover here. They just retool.
London's first pass is going to be complete at the 25-yard line. Fighting his way to the 28 is Kenny Cheatham. Now we'd like to welcome you to Lincoln, Nebraska. It is a cold and windy day. Overcast skies have now moved in, but it has been sunshine as far as the Nebraska Cornhuskers are concerned. The number three and undefeated Nebraska leading 63-7 along with Dave Lapham and Jim Knox. I'm Rob Thulin, and believe it or not, all the years I've been coming here, almost 20 years now, and people have actually left the football game. I've never seen empty stands here ever. This is a first. I think they know this one's in hand. Keep it on the ground to Jason. Trying to give the seniors some playing time. That is what Tom Osborne had hoped for. They have one more game left, the Nebraska Cornhuskers. That'll be that November 28th battle with Colorado. You know, 8, 9, 10 weeks ago, that was expected to be the battle to see who wins the North. Boy, were we surprised.
Yeah, absolutely. And boy, I just saw something, Ron, that's extraordinary for a center on that play. Josh Heskew pulled, snapped the football, and pulled like a guard down the line of scrimmage and cut a guy to the ground, two people removed from him. That just doesn't happen. I mean, that's just an unbelievable effort by a very athletic center.
There's the junior out of UConn, Oklahoma. The fullback straight up the middle, Billy Legate. Out of Clearwater, Florida.
Now, what a center tries to do from time to time is either reach people or, if you can, release to the next level to get to the linebacker level. The last play I was talking about, Heskew just reaching down the line of scrimmage. Take a look at what he does here. Snaps his football, vacates, escapes, gets between two down linemen and locks up the linebacker. That's a heck of a player. I mean, he just sustains his block, sustains contact, and takes him to the ground. Quickness and great hand placement and tremendous body strength.
If I said Clearwater, Florida, I'm Billy Legate, I meant to say Clearwater, Nebraska. Although he would probably rather be in Clearwater, Florida right about now.
Yeah.
Nebraska just pounding it away with Jay Sims again.
James Reed got some penetration. That's the first time I've seen, I think, Nebraska thrown for a loss. I don't think they've had a play that went behind the line of scrimmage all day. And Reed was the disruptor that caused, for the very first time, them to go backwards.
Eric Anderson is, I think, the guy that he may have gotten by, the senior out of right here in Lincoln, Nebraska. 17 pancakes versus Missouri last week, 84 on the season.
Reed, the former linebacker, has now got his hand down in a three-point stance. He's got quickness up front. He penetrated well into the Nebraska offensive line that time.
Second and 10, ball is on the 11. London with a pitchback. Nice job keeping his hands out. Sims looking for the ball line, doesn't get it. Run out of bounds at the 2.
Well, two things. Ball carried by Sims. Extremely accurate pitch by London. A devastating block by fullback Billy Legate. I thought that Sims was going to score because Legate took his guy to the turf. Watch the accuracy of this pitch, London. It is right on the money. Legate's block, he takes his man to the turf. Sims, a little hesitant on the cut to make, and as a result of that hesitancy, the inside-out pursuit gets him because Legate's block was a pancake. I mean, throw some syrup on that one. That baby was on the griddle.
Well, I'm going to talk about that after this play. Third down and one, ball is on the 2. Sims and Legate in the backfield. London looks to throw it, knocked down, fourth down, Nebraska. Talking to Dave Roberts at Baylor a couple of weeks ago, he said how he was amazed that on one play versus Nebraska, there were as many as 8 defensive players on the ground. He said they just crush people.
They do. I mean, their definition of a block that's finished is when the guy's on the ground. I mean, that's finishing a block. Like I said before, even with their wide receivers, they have categories. Knockdowns, of course, and a stone is a devastating block, and a blazer is a block that leads to a touchdown. So they take great pride in knocking bodies around defensively.
Fourth down and 1. Ball is on the 2. London is going to keep it. He's not going to get the first down. He's going to be stacked up short, and Iowa State holds. Doug Densmore, the redshirt freshman, makes the stop. We have a timeout. We'll return to Memorial Stadium after this word from Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. I'm Ron Thulin coming your way. Iowa State with a first really big-time stop on Nebraska. They have the ball at the 2. Davis stacked up at the goal line. Carlos Polk, number 13, the freshman out of Rockford, Illinois, coming up with a stop.
Now, this is dangerous. If Nebraska shoots a gap and hits it in the backfield, you get safety. So, you know, you have to make a decision if you're calling plays. Steve Loney's in a tough spot for Iowa State as an offensive coordinator. Do you really pull your horns in and get ultra-conservative, or do you open it up and try to get out of this bad field position but risk a sack or a penalty in the end zone for a safety?
Second and 11. They say he lost a yard on the play. Ball is sitting on the two-yard line. The crowd is very loud. Bandauer going down the middle. Pass is incomplete. Again, he had a receiver. Damon Green looked like he may be able to run underneath that.
Bandauer put that ball in the air about 50 yards fairly effortlessly right there. Bandauer does have a good throwing arm, big strong body. Not the quickest footed guy in the world, but a little play action fake kind of freezes the linebackers a little bit, but nobody fooled in the secondary. A bunch of bodies in the vicinity. Look, three red jerseys around Green. Nobody gets sucked up in that play action in the secondary. Nice job by Quint.
Yeah, the freshman out of Scotts Bluff, Nebraska. Third down and 11. Ball on the two.
Tough call for Steve Loney right here. You get a third and long, and you're backed up in the shadow of your own end zone.
Bandauer sees some pressure. They complete it to Davis. Takes a big hit as he nears the 10. Knocked out of bounds at the 9-yard line. Brandon Harrison coming up to make the stop.
Slow to get up in the end zone is a big offensive lineman for Iowa State, working his way to the sideline under his own power. I thought it was a good call by Steve Loney, though. You bought a little bit more field position, and so now the punter's not back on the end line of the end zone. At least he's got some room to operate. Plus, you gave Bandauer a two-way go, a run-pass option to throw it away on the perimeter.
Eighth punt for Gomez. Brandon Harrison, we thought, had the concussion. He is back in the ballgame for Nebraska. Again, Newcomb standing at the 45-yard line of Iowa State. Not a good kick. Taken right at the 40.
Uh-oh.
Look out!
Uh-oh.
Devin Wiggins all the way down inside the 5, down to the 4-yard line.
Gomez took him down. He's going to catch a lot of heat from his teammates in the film room. They're going to say to Wiggins, how could the punter tackle you inside the 5-yard line? Wiggins almost took it to the house. But Gomez is there to make the final hit, prevent the touchdown.
Number 5, Shevin Wiggins, had 16 returns, was averaging about 10.5 a return coming into the game. His longest was 32. This one went for 36. And again, Nebraska right on the doorstep of Iowa State. First and goal, ball is on the 4. Frankie London is the quarterback. He's going to keep it. Touchdown, Nebraska.
Well, you can't get much shorter a field to work with.
Oh, you can't.
And it didn't take long to finalize. Wiggins, great return. Gomez, the punter, makes the play. But Frankie London says, you can only delay the inevitable so long. I'm going to pierce the end zone myself right here.
Fifth time over 400 yards rushing the football this season for Nebraska. They are 83-0 under Tom Osborne when rushing for 400 yards.
And the sixth time this season, they're over 500 yards total offense. This is a juggernaut.
Retzlaff to attempt the extra point again. Let me take that back. It wasn't Retzlaff. It's somebody who isn't even on the board. So it must be a senior.
It's Haddenfeld.
Haddenfeld.
Yes, sir.
He must be a senior.
I want to buy a vowel. Look at that. There's a lot of letters across the back. Come on, Vanna. Let me buy I.
Well,
there's almost every letter in the alphabet across the back of those shoulders.
One more letter, it'd be Haddenfeld. That H wouldn't make it on there, would it?
I'm telling you, it'd be curling around those shoulder pads.
Well, he's not on our 2, 3, or 4 deep roster.
Frankie London, little option down the line of scrimmage. He sees that he's got an option to take it to the end zone himself and not risk any kind of a problem by pitching the football, and he finalizes.
Well, he says he's a sophomore. So he got his name in the books, but Nebraska leads 70-7 with 3:08 left in the third. Let's go down to Jim Knox. Jim?
Okay, Ron, before 1900, the Nebraska football team that was not always known as the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Check out some of the names. Before 1900, there were the Nebraska Golden Knights along with the Nebraska Antelopes and the Nebraska Buttock Eaters. Now, in 1900, a sports editor from the local newspaper decided enough is enough. He stuck the name Cornhuskers on them and has stuck with them ever since. Nebraska Bug Eaters, that's not too intimidating.
Not hardly. Here's Tyrone Watley. He's already set a school record for return yardage, and he's adding to that.
What?
Up to the 34-yard line, Tyrone Watley. He has been the lone bright spot this afternoon.
Tell you, a guy like Tyrone Watley, if he doesn't play at the next level, this is his sixth year. He petitioned for a very unusual scenario with his sixth year of eligibility. He had a heart problem at University of Pacific, and football is extremely important to this young guy, and he's not going to quit. No matter what the score is, no matter what the scenario situation, he's going to go for the gusto. And if he doesn't play at the next level, any corporate executive watching, interview this kid, because he's going to give you everything he's got in any business opportunity that presents itself.
219 yards on kickoff returns today. He's had nine chances. Todd Bandauer's pass intended for Williams incomplete. Ed Williams has been very, very quiet. He's had one opportunity, obviously, in the first quarter that could have been a touchdown if it was not overthrown.
Yep. They had an opportunity on their first possession, couldn't execute it, fell behind 7-0, and then, of course, it got progressively worse from there. But if you have a secondary that's concerned about defending the W boys, Watley and Williams, the best thing to do to help your secondary is put extreme pressure on Bandauer, and that's what Nebraska's done.
Bandauer steps up in the pocket, throws off balance, intended for Williams, and it's going to be incomplete.
And Ron, just like you described it, the reason that ball was not connected, throws off balance, thrown across his body, can't transfer from the back foot to the front foot, finishes mechanics. Why? People all around him. I mean, red jerseys everywhere. The pressure has been extreme and intense. Here's a kid that's completed over 50% of his passes for the year. He's 8 for 31 in this one. And the reason for most of those 23 incompletions has been the defensive front line putting pressure on him.
Third down and 10.
Uh-oh. Left tackle moved. I'm not sure if the defense pierced the neutral zone before the left tackle moved, but Oliver Ross did break his stance, but the defense jumped in the neutral zone first. Let's see what they call.
Dead ball. Offside.
Yep.
Defense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
Well, it's third and five now. Iowa State 6-15 on third down conversions.
Derek Allen, the big fella that had caused a fumble earlier in the half, is the one that was a little bit antsy up front.
Well, Nebraska only allowing opponents 23% success rate on third down conversions this year, and Charlie McBride telling us yesterday they're very pleased with that number.
They should be.
That's low.
Yep.
Green in motion. Bandauer straight back looking for his tight end. Pass is going to be picked off, dropped.
Brown almost had his second interception.
Jason Bettis.
Yeah.
The senior from Valparaiso, Nebraska, looking for his first interception.
You know, when you're in the pocket as a quarterback, you're extremely vulnerable. And Bandauer is standing there very tall. The pressure starts to come. They could light him up a little bit, but they don't. They kind of pull off. And they could have put that helmet right in the rib cage and broken that seventh rib, but they decide not to do that. There's no need to go crazy here.
But Steve Warren did usher him to the turf a little bit there at the end.
Yep.
Bobby Newcomb practices two positions during the week. He was the third team quarterback coming into this year. Back to receive the punt. Already returned one for a touchdown. Has run one in. A high short kick. Newcomb's telling everybody to get away from him.
Grab it, Newcomb.
Shevin Wiggins backs away. That ball's going to be down inside the 10. Down to the 8-yard line.
Now, Frank Gann's a great special teams coach that was with the Bengals at one time, did a study. When you let the ball hit the turf on AstroTurf, you lose 16 yards of field position. His point is, whenever you can fair catch it, get up there and catch the football. Don't let it hit the turf. It'll cost you more than a first down.
Let's take a look at some scores from around the Big 12 Conference. Missouri leading Baylor in the second. Texas up by a field goal over Kansas. Texas Tech.
That's a big game for Kansas, Ron, because if they get their sixth win, they qualify for a bowl. If they don't, The Big 12 only sends five teams a game.
And tonight it'll be A&M visiting Norman, Oklahoma to take on the Sooners. Straight up the middle, pounding his way.
Dan Alexander,
that's that big tailback, but he's actually played fullback on that play. The big guy, 250-pound redshirt freshman out of Missouri.
Oh,
look at the guns on him.
He's got guns. He's got the pythons. He's got the quads. Watch him run over. Ooh, that's running a guy over. I mean, that's humiliating a defensive player right there. Michael Cooper, pretty good player himself, just got steamrolled. That wasn't a pancake. That was flatter than a pancake.
I stood next to that young man yesterday. He is thick.
Ooh,
look out. Oh. That is some explosion for Dan Alexander.
Looks like Zonka. He
does,
runs with the body lean and Larry Zonka. And you get in this kid's way, look at the definition of those arms. He's getting sight. He's jacked up for another opportunity. When he hits the line of scrimmage, he's going north and south and going hard. And boy, if he squares his shoulder pads up, you better make that big guy run to the sideline a little bit, go east and west, because when he gets those pads squared up to the line of scrimmage going north and south, El Lodo.
This season, 13 rushes, 44 yards. He may have it. Got a couple of carries this afternoon. London in trouble. Keeps his feet. And London has the bridge knocked from underneath him.
Oh, I like it.
Right at about the 30. We're pulling them all out, Dave. It's 70-7, big guy.
The London bridge came falling down.
It's yours and my last game of the year. I've saved them all up the whole year for this one.
Falling down.
I don't know about your singing, but.
Oh, boy, don't make us sing.
No,
oh,
please don't.
London tried to make something out of nothing there, but he kind of equalized. It ended up being nothing.
Second down and 11. 41 seconds left in the third quarter. A 70-7 ball game. Big surge by that line of Nebraska. Alexander tries to keep his feet as he crosses the 31 up to about the 33-yard line.
Very smart play by Ansley. He went to his shoe tops. He said, I'm not going to mess with Alexander up front, up top. I'm going down by where he ties his shoes and make the big fella jump over me, because if I hit him above his thigh boards, I'm a crazy man.
Well, I saw that Dan Alexander yesterday. I'm telling you, it was cold, it was snowing, and he comes out, has those big arms sticking out of about, looking like a tank top, and asked him if he's cold. He went, nah.
He's a tank and a tank top right there.
Well, that's the end of the third quarter of play. Nebraska only scores one touchdown, but they were up by a bunch to begin with. 70-7 as we head to the final stanza. Not too far away from Memorial Stadium, where Nebraska leads 70-7 as we head to the final stanza. Third down and 8 for the Cornhuskers. They're 6 of 7. They've only had 7 third down opportunities today.
They haven't punted yet. I mean,
nope.
He hasn't earned his letter yet today.
No, he may not get the uni dirty. They won't have to wash that bad boy. London's going to keep it. London's going to be dropped. Maybe picked up 2 on a play. James Reed on the stop. Scott Frost is out of the game. He had a full day already. Amon Green, who had 599 yards the last 3 years against Iowa State, which is the most yards by a Husker against a single opponent. Previous record was 596 by Calvin Jones. Amon Green also had 200-yard rushing games back-to-back years against Iowa State, and that's only the second time in Nebraska history that has happened.
And Cush, back to punt. Can't believe it.
Jesse Cush, the senior out of Columbus, Nebraska. Dad's a Nebraska Hall of Fame defensive back. Played in 70-71 with Bob Devaney and company. Ball is going to be down. Jesse may have been a little cold standing on the sideline.
He's freezing. He's a statue out there. It's hard to get loose.
But you know what? He can tell us all about the weather because he's a meteorology and climatology major.
He can tell us it's cold today.
Yeah, really. He uses the direct viewing device, right?
Yeah.
Goes outside and says, yeah, it's cold and it's wet.
He's still, even though he's averaging under 40 yards a punt this season, he's still in position to be the all-time career best average punter in Nebraska history.
Vandauer still at quarterback. Davis gets up to the 40, and that is where he is going to be brought down after a pickup of 4. 1 minute gone by here in the fourth. Greg List, a sophomore out of Valentine, Nebraska, on the stop.
I've never been in a football game down 63 points, fortunately, but I've been in games where you're down 30 in the fourth quarter, and at that point, you're playing for pride. You know, it's character builder. There's no doubt about it. Now, the coaches want to find out who the front runners are, who the guys are that are going to play hard when you're getting obliterated.
Davis again. He is going to be stacked up. Brian Shaw, the first one to make the hit. Now, the executive producer of Fox Sports Net, Arthur Smith and Bill Vorson. Coordinating producer of college football is Roy Hamilton. Today's game was produced by Robert Steinfeld, Kenny Miller, and head of field operations is Andrea Jenkins. Of course, there's one more Big 12 game left on our syndicated package next week. Bill Land and Artie Gigantino and Jim Knox will be on hand to cover that ball game. We'd like to thank for Dave and thank Bob Steinfeld and Kenny Miller, our director, for making us look so good throughout the year.
I tell you, they're awesome. It's a heck of a tandem. We got a great group, Ron, top to bottom.
And we can out-eat any college football team in America.
Absolutely.
Bandauer's pass is complete to Ed Williams. Speaking of eating.
Yes.
You and I have been together 3 years now, Dave. We were the SEC a couple years ago.
Right.
Not bad food.
No, big groceries.
Big 12, though, kicks them big time, I think.
Well, I'm a meat and potatoes guy. And
lots of meat and potatoes.
Yeah. Protein overdose is my specialty in the Big 12. There's not a better place to be to enjoy some fine beef than in the Big 12 country, I'll tell you.
Boy, you can tell it's 70-7, can't you? Davis tries the right side up to the 43-yard line. Top five, Misties, right here in Lincoln, Nebraska.
Excellent piece of prime rib last night. Melt in your mouth. It was awesome.
Iowa State, Ames, Iowa, has a pretty good barbecue place.
Oh, does it ever. As good as it gets. Hickory Park.
Juanita's in Boulder, Colorado. Dave Platty took us there. Good Mexican food in Boulder.
50-yard line.
50-yard line in Texas Tech in Lubbock.
Yep.
Tom's in College Station.
Some good stuff.
Old AC, Alan Cannon, filled us up there. Davis tripped up as he nears the 30-yard line. That's where they're going to mark it. Julius Jackson, a sophomore out of Gainesville, Texas, tripped him up.
I'll tell you a guy that I've got a lot of respect for. We're going to take a look at what Darren Davis got done here, but there's a gentleman I got a lot of respect for that's laboring up front in the offensive line. But Darren Davis gets a good block from Parmentier. As they get the corner secured, he finds a little bit of a lane to take advantage of. Stiff arm gets him up the football field. Stiff arms Jackson to get the extra yards. The guy that I got a tremendous amount of respect for is Charlie Bogwell, a center.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, the guy is playing hurt. He's playing every snap, and they're down by 63 points. This kid has got a big heart.
Bandauer straight back, fires the pass, and is complete. To number 80, Andy Stensrud, whose dad, Mike Stensrud, All-American at Iowa State, have a penalty flag thrown in the backfield, could be holding.
Yep.
We have to talk about the fact that Bogwell is playing. Ben Bruns, the backup center, holding, redshirt holding. Freshman.
Offense.
Out of Iowa. He had arthroscopic surgery, so he is out.
And Charlie's got that big old brace on his right arm. I'm not sure if he might have been the one they called for holding right there. It'd be tough for him. He's lobbying a little bit with the official, and I think he might have been the guy that was called for holding, and he's talking it over with the umpire saying, I can't believe you called me. I only got one arm. I'm a one-arm paper hanger out here, and you're calling me for holding? Man, I guess I must be pretty good with that one arm. But
he's
here's
strong.
A guy that's right arm, right-handed, and you can see the big device. He's got a sleeve over it now, but it's a big apparatus to stabilize it. So as a result, he has to snap with his left hand. And if you're a defensive lineman, you're going to pass rush to that right side trying to take advantage of that bad wing. But he's in there every snap.
First and 24, Davis going to be stacked up at the 45-yard line. Didn't get back to the line of scrimmage. Let's send it down to Jim Knox.
All right, Ron, there he is, Matt Davison, who made that miracle catch against Missouri last week. Now, I had a chance to talk with Matt yesterday. He told me what a week it's been for him. All week he's been receiving email, a lot of letters from around the state of Nebraska, not to mention he was the big man around campus. Everybody congratulated him on the big catch. Even his professors picked him out in class and said congratulations. Now, he did tell me about how subdued Tom Osborne was after last week's game. He said he walked on the bus as they were about to get on the plane. He said Tom Osborne looked up at him. He looked back down at Tom, and Coach Osborne said, Matt, good catch. That was it. Just good catch.
That's good. That's good.
That's tremendous excitement out of Coach Osborne, though. I mean, just to acknowledge it. He is the most even-keel personality I think I've ever seen. They're calling Iowa State for illegal snap, double clutching that football. Once you get it started, you got to finish your snap. You can't start it, stop it, and start it again. But Coach Osborne, I mean, it's amazing. When you look at him at the sideline, a lot of times. You can't tell if he's up 63 or down 7. And it was amazing to watch him.
Head ball. Snap infraction. On the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
It was amazing to watch him in Columbia, Missouri. And he said at one point, you know, I thought we were done for after the game. But looking at him, look at the clock and try to think one play ahead with his play selection and the poise that he showed that filtered down to his quarterback, Scott Frost, on the field and in that huddle was incredible. And the record, because of that poise, speaks for itself.
Second and 29. Still 10:35 to play in the fourth. Over the middle, pass is tipped incomplete. And Bandauer goes down again in a pile.
Nice job by Julius Jackson to get back in his zone and deflect that football. He put it airborne. Somebody could have broken on it and made the play, but J.J. got his hands up there pretty well. Athletic. And, you know, the linebackers, the key in zone coverage is how quickly the linebackers can get their drops and how deep they can get their drops. If you don't have a big separation between linebackers and safeties in your zone defense, it's going to be tough to throw the football.
Third down and 29 for Iowa State. Ball just about on the 50-yard line. Two wide receivers to the right. Here comes the rush. They dump it off to Davis. Oh, slips and falls as he crosses the 40 down to the 37-yard line. Well short of the first down.
Unassisted tackle by the turf monster that time. Nobody really got a hand on him as Darren Davis tried to make that violent cut. His feet went out from under him and kerplunk.
Fourth down and 18. Iowa State's going to go for it. Bandauer stays in the ballgame. He is one tough young man. He's a 3.6 grade point average student in engineering. Has a school record for touchdown passes. He's the captain of the team, and he still has one more year for Dan McCartney. Here comes the blitz. State, nice job picking it up. They're going deep. They have a man. The pass is complete down to the 11-yard line. That'll be a first down for Iowa State.
Tremendous flag, a late hit out of bounds. Wadley trying to keep his composure. Don't retaliate because right now you're the beneficiary of a penalty. And he ends up walking away from it. Tremendous route by Wadley. I think it was Willie Miller. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm not sure who
Joe
it was.
Joe Walker?
That he turned around. He completely turned somebody around, ran a post corner. You saw him start it. Yeah, it was Joe Walker. He started to the post, and then he ran a corner route, a double move, and turned Joe Walker completely around. And then the late hit out of bounds, the late push by Walker, and that's an unsportsmanlike conduct that gives him half the distance of the goal. And the best thing that Watley did was get his hands down to his side, don't retaliate, and nullify that advantage because now they find themselves first to goal inside the 6-yard line.
Big, big fourth down conversion for Iowa State. Just a morale booster. They're right. Not giving up. You know, we talked at the beginning of the game that Dan McCartney's teams play hard.
Yep.
And a lot of teams would pitch the tent right about now and say, it's over. These guys continue to fight.
And this kid, Watley, Dan McCartney's got a lot of respect for him because he may have the biggest heart on the team, and he ran a great double move route that last time.
First and goal from the 5. Davis stiff arms his way, touchdown Iowa State.
Boy, did you call that stiff arm. That was one of those right to the puss and down to the turf. Nebraska fell off of him like he hussed him like an ear of corn right there. Darren Davis he had that stiff arm going big time. Watch this right arm, ba-kunk, down you go. No chance right there. It's like, see ya.
This may be stretching the moral victory cliche, but actually Iowa State and Nebraska tied 7-7 here in the second half.
I have no idea who that young man is. He's not on my flip card. That's why I haven't identified number 27 in the red.
Bull's extra point is good. Darren Davis, 62 yards, rushing the football and a touchdown. We still have 9:36 to play. Nebraska leading at 70-14. Iowa State in the first quarter, then they hung a 28 on them in the second. That was the difference.
That'll hurt you. That'll hurt you when they put 63 on the board at the half. That was a long 30 minutes for them.
It was an hour-long first quarter. Kickoff to Brandon Harrison's going to let it go out of bounds. Penalty flag will be thrown.
Now you get great field position out of this. You start at the 35-yard line.
That is where Nebraska will take over. First and 10, 9:31 to play in the ballgame. Scott Frost is quarterback of the team. Frankie London remains in. Cross played about as well as you can possibly play. Ran the option to perfection. Passed the ball well. Good support from Amon Green. Joel Makavica with a touchdown today. Complete team effort.
And the key to all of those stars performing is the guys up front. You know, right. they dominated and let the guys, the actual touchdown makers, do their thing.
London played four games last year, was a sprinter in high school. He's got good speed. Not going to be able to show it on that play. Gets thumped right at the line of scrimmage. Derek Clark, number 11, a senior out of Livermore, Iowa, on the stop.
Boy, the Nebraska wide receivers are so physical when they block. That time, Sean Applegate came inside as a wide receiver and had a crackback block and hit the linebackers like a fullback would. I mean, these wide receivers, Coach Brown does an outstanding job with these guys blocking on the perimeter. They're just incredibly gifted.
They take a lot of pride in it.
Yep.
London hands it off to Alexander. He tries the left side. Nothing doing. Let's take a look at our Southwest Airlines game summary for this afternoon. It is a simple game summary. All you have to do is look at the 35 first quarter points, 63 and a half, tie in some school records.
There's the story, the rushing yards.
Whew. Big time.
42 as opposed to 430. I mean, Nebraska's got 10 times the rushing yards that Iowa State does. That's the ball game.
Texas Tech, don't forget, only had 17 rushing yards against this Nebraska defense. And there is Scott Frost on the sideline. One game left in the regular season. They will go to San Antonio, however, for the Big 12 championship game on December 6th. Tickets are still available, I might add. Had to say that for Derek Fox and Bob Generelli down there in San Antonio. Make sure to get that plug in for the tickets. Having lived in San Antonio, living there now, come on down, folks. I tell you, it's a great place. You'll have a ball down there.
Nice city, huh?
Great city. 8:08 left to play in the ballgame, 70-14.
I can't believe it. Punting again.
Second. My goodness.
Took until the fourth quarter, but Cush is now starting to get that left leg loose a little bit.
Opponents have only had 9 returns coming into this game. You can see his first effort.
That's a little better.
Much better. Wilson. Ball is loose. Let's see who's got it. I think maybe Nebraska picked it up.
They sure did.
Let's see what they say. Yes, indeed. Nebraska's got the football again.
Vandenbosch has got it.
40-yard punt to no avail because Nebraska comes up with the ball. We'll return to Memorial Stadium after this word from Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Nebraska has the football, and behind him, the only sideline I've ever seen with a hot chocolate dispenser.
You gotta love that. Vandenbosch with a double dip ice cream cone. He stripped it and recovered it. Nice play.
As we keep our food theme working for this afternoon.
Yes, it's cold for that double dip ice cream, though.
Willie Miller, a freshman out of Omaha, Nebraska, on the carry as the clock continues to run, and unfortunately, Iowa State has not been able to do that today. That has been the difference.
I'll tell you, my goal next year, though, if we have another Nebraska game, is to make pregame meal with those guys. The menu that Jim showed us, I'd like to throw down some groceries with the Huskers. That'd be a lot of fun. 7:30 in the morning, all those groceries available.
Sheesh. I'll tell you, they invited us for their Thursday night steak dinner. I like that one.
Yeah, that'll work.
That dog will hunt for sure. Dancing around in the backfield, Jay Sims, not much running room. Derek Clark on the stop. Well, let's take a look at Scott Frost for this season. He could become the 10th quarterback, as Dave mentioned earlier, in NCAA history with 1,000 and 1,000.
Needs
56 yards passing, 60 rushing.
That'd be outstanding. And he's more than capable of getting that done for sure. This kid is a real threat with the football in his hands two ways. I mean, he's more than adequate throwing the football. He can run with the best of them.
London on the option, keeps it himself. Inside the 25 to the 23-yard line. Let's take a look at our Dr. Pepper conference leaders. And it is scoring. Ricky Williams on top, averaging over 13 and a half a game. Frost, Green, and Brown, 2, 3, and 4.
And Green helped himself today. 3 touchdowns today. That average is going to go up. Scott Frost's average will go up as well.
Yep.
This football team is a powerhouse. I mean, they came into this football game averaging over 45 points a game, and that'll go up.
Well, fourth down and one, in case you're wondering why they go for it, kicking a field goal would be kind of running up the score. Now you allow Iowa State at least to stop you.
They control their own destiny.
Pitch it back to Sims. He's got the first down.
They did it earlier when Iowa State inside the five-yard line. Instead of kicking the field goal to make it 66 when they had 63 points on the board, they said, well, if you can stop us on fourth down, you get the ball. And Iowa State did. They got the ball back.
That'll be a first and 10, ball on the 20 with 5:58 to play. 70-14 is our score. In case you just joined us, it was 63-7 at halftime.
And as you look in that huddle, not one starter is on the football field. I mean, they've got backups up and down the line of scrimmage and in the backfield.
Straight ahead. Ben Kingston, sophomore out of Omaha, Nebraska, number 22, only had two carries coming into this game for 4 yards. So he'll get his name in the books today.
You know, Ron, the amazing thing about this Nebraska team, though, even when they're redshirt freshmen, their practices are so efficient. I mean, they've got two offensive units and two defensive units taking a bunch of snaps. Repetition, repetition. Yeah. Tom Osborne has his team as organized as anybody. They come on the field to play as redshirt freshmen, and they understand how to execute those plays. They've run them a bunch.
Another quarterback, Monte Cristo, is in the lineup.
The count.
The count out of Kearney, Nebraska. 6 foot, 200 pounder.
He was he got sandwiched on that play. A little high-low. It's a good along the food theme.
Well, we are keeping it, aren't we?
The count is, the count will get it done. 6 feet, a couple hundred pounds.
We'll be appearing in Vegas all next week.
So yeah. You wanna... At Chuckles Club.
Yeah, we can do that.
Oh boy.
4:35 to play. Not moving fast enough for Dan McCarty. Christo keeps it!
Double dribble. He dribbled into the end zone, but he was down at about the 1 yard line.
Oh, Christo saw his name going in the books.
Man, nice effort. He exploded to the end zone to the goal line, but he just got tripped up. Followed his blockers up the football field, squared up his shoulder pads, and somebody just nipped his heels. Nice effort right there as he's diving for the end zone. Is that Carlos Polk? Kevin Hudson that made the play, the diving play.
First and goal from the one. Touchdown, Nebraska. Josh Cobb.
Got their 11 touchdowns. 77 points. Woo.
Cobb's first touchdown of the year. Here's a guy that played six-man football in high school.
It's a good place to be with your last name Cobb, Cornhusker.
Well, this is the most points. Most points ever scored by an opponent versus Iowa State. Previous was 73-14, Nebraska over ISU. That was back in 95. Only you come up with that one.
Oh,
that was good.
There's a lot of strewn cobs out there today, but the Cornhuskers are doing a job.
Ted Retzlaff's extra point is good. 4:04 to play in the ball game, and it's all Nebraska by a bunch. 77-14, Josh Anderson set to kick it away for Nebraska. 13 different players have carried the ball for Nebraska. 9 rushing touchdowns, ties a school record. Set back in 83 versus Minnesota. Iowa State trying to get good field position, and they will.
I love Watley. This kid won't quit.
Well, our Dr. Pepper player of the game is Amon Green, the junior out of Omaha, Nebraska.
Jeez, look at those numbers.
9th consecutive 100-yard game, 209 on just 15 carries. Not a bad average. And here is one of the TDs.
Well, nice blocking up front. He follows that fullback's lead block. And then once he gets the open spaces, he turns the after jets on and see ya. He's a rare combination of speed, power, agility. He's got it all.
Well, Sage Rosenfels is coming to the lineup to play quarterback now for Iowa State. Jerome Evans on the carry over the left side, picks up a few yards.
Well, the AP top five in the remaining schedules, you can see Michigan plays Wisconsin today, then, of course, their annual tilt with Ohio State.
I wonder if Ohio State can reverse the role. Michigan kept them from a national championship basically last year with an upset win.
Florida State, big game, November 22nd at Florida. Nebraska has one more left.
Right after Thanksgiving against Colorado at Boulder.
Nebraska's still sitting in a great position to win the national championship.
No question.
Iowa State just keeping it on the bounce. Heavens, who had a pretty decent game last week against Colorado, bounces his way up to the 40. That'll be good for a first down.
The one difference, I think, when you look at Michigan, you look at Florida State, they have solid defensive units in every position group. I think Nebraska has a defensive, championship defensive unit in the front line. I think the linebackers are solid. The secondary, being so young and inexperienced, though, is suspect. And if they do match up with Florida State in the Orange Bowl, if that Busby can get things going, Florida State's defensive unit being so tough, that'd be an interesting matchup.
2:50 to play. Rosenfels hands it off again to Heavens. From the 40 to the 43-yard line, a gain of three. Lauren Kaiser, a freshman out of Farewell, Nebraska, on the stop with Tom Osborne. Keeps the record perfect.
He's going to have his team in position for a national championship many, many years now. Even with the 85 scholarship rule, because of the continuity in the program that we've already spoken about. He's been here 25 years. He's got a bunch of assistants that have been here 15 years or more, as many as 21 years.
Yep.
And that says a lot.
Third in wins among active coaches. Rosenfels tucks it in up to the 50-yard line. That'll be close to the first down as we near the two-minute mark here of quarter number four. You know, you talk about that, those assistants, Dave. They recruit about 35 to 40 states here in Nebraska. And the coaches, if you lose two or three assistants a year, Charlie McBride and company feel that you lose 25% of your recruiting power. So they don't want to lose assistant coaches to other schools because it really hurts in their recruiting effort.
No doubt. Charlie McBride right there, he's had offers from the Green Bay Packers, the Denver Broncos. He could be coaching the NFL. He wants to be here at Nebraska. He's exactly where he wants to be.
On third and one, Iowa State will get the first down as they cross the 50 down to about the 49-yard line of Nebraska.
And I do know that after having played with some kids that play, or guys that played here at Nebraska, the Dave Remingtons I was a teammate of, and Jim Scow with the Cincinnati Bengals, a defensive end that was a great one here for Charlie McBride. These guys, there's something about this Nebraska Cornhusker program. I mean, it's like one big extended family.
Yeah.
Remington, Scow, I can't remember how many times they talked about Coach Osborne, Coach McBride, and the impact they had in their lives. It's amazing.
Heavens, right side, another Iowa State first down as he gets down to about the 38-yard line. 63 seconds left to play in the football game. The crowd, well, they've been leaving since about midway through the third quarter. Highly unusual here at Memorial Stadium. One of the great places to do a football game. I'll tell you, our hotel and the restaurant last night, the band comes into the restaurant.
Yep.
This is a remarkable place, and Chris Anderson and everybody here in Lincoln, we thank you for your hospitality. It's been fun.
It's a great venue, a great place for college football.
45 seconds left, not moving fast enough. Rosenfeld looking for Pater. Pass is going to be intercepted at the three.
Wow. Buckhalter. Is that Buckhalter that made that play?
Well, it's either Finister.
DeMond Finister. Yeah, it's Finister. At any rate, it's the eighth interception of the year, I think.
Yep, that's right. So two today.
Yeah, they came in with six and picked up two today. And they got a third of the interceptions that they had on the season just today. A nice play on that one. Full extension on the vertical, securing the football. Really, though, Iowa State, what you have to do if you're a receiver on that play, you have to reverse roles and you have to play defender.
Here's our sit-go stats, and you can see 584 yards, total yards for Nebraska.
Iowa State, five turnovers, five giveaways. You can't do that with a team as talented as Nebraska.
This should be the final play of the game. Nebraska will keep it on the ground up to about the 8-yard line, and that should be it. Final 30 seconds, Nebraska, 77-14. Chalk one in the books for them. They will go to 10-0 on the year. 7-0 in the Big 12 Conference. They will win the North title. They are on their way to San Antonio for the Big 12 championship game.
And they have a week off to get healthy for Colorado. And they've got some guys that are banged up, so that week off should help.
Now they're going to sneak in one more play.
Number 16,
Jay. That'll do it. In front of their 220th consecutive sellout, they win again here in Lincoln.
Well, two things that happened Iowa State didn't want to have happen was problems in the kicking game and turning the football over. Those are two things that you hope you do well against Nebraska, is perform in the kicking game and secure the football. And all they did was add gasoline to the Nebraska fire, and it just raged out of control.
42 consecutive wins here at Memorial Stadium for the Huskers. They win it, and they do it in fine fashion. 77-14 is our final.